Atlanta. Coverage starts with Cubs pregame live presented by Verizon Wireless. Cubs Braves today at 5:30 on Comcast SportsNet.
Today, Northern Illinois tries to catch fire as it opens the MAC season at home against Ohio. Look for Garrett Wolf to ignite the attack and lead the charge against the Bobcats. Beautiful day in DeKalb, Illinois. It's Husky Stadium, Brigham Field, the site. It's the Ohio Bobcats and the Northern Illinois Huskies. Good afternoon, everybody. Alongside former NFL standout Tom Waddle, I'm David Kaplan. Last week, Tommy, Northern Illinois had the ultimate test. They had to go to the Horseshoe in Columbus, Ohio, battle maybe the best team in the country in Ohio State.
Wow, what a way to start your season, right? Play Ohio State in Columbus. The Huskies actually did some positive things. They moved the football. They just didn't finish their drives, and ultimately it cost them. Listen, no shame in losing to the number one team in the country on the road. You put that game in your rearview mirror, and you concentrate on what the goal was to start the season. That's a MAC title, and it begins today with Ohio.
All right, when you look at Northern Illinois, it starts with one of the best players in the country, a legitimate Heisman candidate, tailback Garrett Wolf.
This little guy can play, huh? You're absolutely right. He is a legitimate Heisman candidate. 285 total yards last week against the Buckeyes. His resume is sparkling. 15 career 100-yard rushing afternoons, 6 200-yard days, and 1 300-yard afternoon. If that's not enough, Coach Novak talked at the start of the season, hey, we'd like to get Garrett more involved in the passing attack. You think that keeps some defensive coordinators around the MAC a little sleepless at night? I would say so.
All right, now for Ohio to handle Garrett Wolf, they've got to keep him off the field, and that will start with their great back, Junior.
Down. Frank Solich, his teams would rather out-hit you than out-scheme you, and it starts with the running game. They're a very disciplined team. They'll establish the run with McCray, mix in some play-action passes, and rely on their defense. They've got 9 returning starters on D. These guys are going to try to slow down Garrett Wolf. I'm not sure if they're going to be able to do it.
All right, they're talking Heisman here in DeKalb. It's Garrett Wolf and the Huskies and the Ohio Bobcats. Sit back, have a great Saturday afternoon of college football. It's coming up on Comcast SportsNet.
You know, there are some things families just don't like to share.
They don't want to share this.
Or this.
Or these.
Or this. That's why with U.S. Cellular's family plan, everyone in the family gets their own phone. Plus, they can talk to each other free.
Speaking of which, does anyone want to talk about these?
Oh, those are Dwayne's!
See, you thought you lost them.
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Right now, get up to 4 free phones when you buy one for only $29.95.
Get reacquainted with an old friend, Eduardo's Mexican Restaurant in downtown DeKalb. Our simple but elegant dining room has been completely remodeled, including commissioned artwork by renowned Chicago artist Oscar Romero. But our great food hasn't changed. We still have the best selection of authentic Mexican dishes, including seasonal specials, all expertly prepared using only the finest and freshest ingredients, and served steaming hot to your table. Eduardo's Mexican Restaurant, downtown DeKalb.
Stop on in, we've got what you need. Stop on in, you're on the run.
At Casey's, we don't do thin and skimpy pizzas. Casey's piles them up real heavy. All month, get free cheese breadsticks with the purchase of any large pizza. Come in now and enter to win the Snickers Casey's Super Bowl Celebration Sweepstakes. You and a friend could end up at Super Bowl 41 in Miami.
Stop on in to Casey's General Store.
So, what are we thinking?
I don't know. What do you think?
Want to try some color?
Yes, I do.
Ha!
Let's get a look at ya.
Supercuts is a proud sponsor of Fitzpatrick Racing. Supercuts, every time.
Let's get you cleaned up.
Supercuts is a proud sponsor of Fitz Bradshaw Racing.
Hey, how's the temperature?
Supercuts, every time.
This broadcast of Northern Illinois Husky football on Comcast SportsNet is brought to you by... Welcome back to Brigham Field at Husky Stadium in DeKalb, Illinois. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle with you. Jim Blaney, roaming the sidelines. And let's take a look at our resource bank. Keys to the game, Tommy.
Well, I think it's quite simple. You have to get the ball to Garrett Wolf early and often. You give it to him 30-plus times, he's going to get you at least 150 yards, and that's going to equate to a Husky victory. Slow down McCray. You got to keep that Ohio running attack on the sideline. Don't let them dictate the pace of the game. And finally, the always creative, win the turnover battle, take care of the football. That's akin to scoring more points than your opponent. I figured we'd get the bad football cliches underway from the get-go.
All right, series history. Huskies lead at 9-7. They haven't met in 3 years. Last one, we were here. It was a real good football game that went to overtime. It's time for the NIU MBA program opening kickoff. Deep will be 31, Josh Abrams, 28. Pardon me, 82, Scott Mayle will be deep. Chris Nendick. We're ready to kick for the Northern Illinois Huskies. Good crowd on hand, beautiful day for football, and the sea of red rises as one, and we are getting the home portion of the schedule underway. Ball in the air, and the clock starts moving. It's bounced around, and Ohio downs it. And they will start first and 10 at their own 20. And Tommy, we do have a couple of rule changes we want to let everyone know about. Some of the coaches not happy with the rules, but the clock now starts as soon as the ball's touched on a kickoff. And after a first down, as soon as the ball's spotted ready for play, it goes.
Yeah, I think that all in college football wanted to make sure they're not playing 3.5-4 hour games. And I think that's the reason why the rules were put in place.
It's the Applebee's starting lineup. You look at the Ohio backs and receivers, and there is their stud tailback, Calvin McCray. Austin Everson will start at quarterback, although Ohio will run a couple of different looks at you from the quarterback spot. We've got markers already flying. Brad Bauer, who is a transfer from Illinois. This is a homecoming for him. He went to Hinsdale and is from Burr Ridge, Illinois. He also will see time at quarterback. We have a false start penalty on Ohio. So they will start first and 15.
And you just got to look at their offensive line. It's an experienced group with three returning starters, two seniors, three juniors. And unfortunately for Ohio, you can't afford these mistakes early in a ball game against a team as talented as Northern.
And a single back set with Calvin McCray.
They did it again.
And I believe another false start's going to be called here on Ohio. The crowd loves it. You see the defense led by a very emotional and fiery Ken West. We were down on the field early. Ken West is foaming at the mouth for this one. Number 34, who will start at defensive end. He's at left end, 6'1", 243, a senior, and one of those real emotional leaders. You see him right there.
And for Ohio, when you're a balanced football team on offense and you rely on the running game to get things started, the last thing you want to face is a first and 20.
Now they'll go out of the shotgun on a first and 20. And they will give it to McCray, and McCray will go relatively nowhere, knocked down, a gain of 2 yards. It'll bring up a second and 18. Let's take a look at the Applebee's NIU Huskies defensive starters. There is Kenny West, Brad Benson, Crutch, and English.
Blaylock, McCarthy, and Corey Hansen getting a start this week. He did not start at Ohio State. Then you see the Hansbrough, Ryder, and Utchick. Good, solid defensive group. Again out of the gun, this time an empty backfield for Ohio. Everson barking out signals. He will go to the air, and he will miss Mail on a short toss, and it will bring up a third and 18 for Ohio.
This is just not a comfortable situation for the Ohio offense. As I said earlier, they're run first, throw second. They've got a veteran quarterback in Austin Everson, but he's not the type to drop back and air it out. When you see an empty backfield and five wide receivers out there for the Bobcat offense, you know things aren't going the way they had planned.
Now, one of the keys that you and I talked about is Northern being able to put pressure on the quarterback. I would expect they will try and tee off right here.
You would think so. It's an attack 4-3, they've always called it. They didn't sack a lot of quarterbacks last season, and quarterback pressure is something Joe Novak wanted to improve on this year.
Everson goes down the field and misses his man. Fires incomplete looking for his receiver, Chido Naakocha.
Good
I think
work.
I got that right.
Good work. Listen, there are not a whole lot of plays designed for third and 18 that you're going to convert on a high percentage.
Chido Naakocha was the intended receiver, so this drive nets them minus 8 yards, and they will punt the football away
into the
net. Lasher, Marcus Perez is the deep man. The punt is away. It's a fairly short kick, though, into the wind. It will bounce around. The Huskies will let it roll, and they will go on the attack. First and 10 at the 45-yard line or thereabouts. The NIU offense comes on the field. You look at their offensive starters, brought to you by Applebee's. Garrett Wolf, Britt Davis, Jake Nordine, Jarrett Carter, and Matt Simon. A 45-yard punt. You see their offensive line anchored by one of the best in the country, Doug Free, who many say is a lock to be a number one NFL draft pick. Phil Horvath, number 3. Senior quarterback with his single back set, one of the best in the country, Garrett Wolf. And Horvath throws and finds his man. Matt Simon makes his next the catch, a gain of 17 yards and a Husky first down.
Just a little seam route for Matt Simon. Horvath finds it in between 3 Ohio defenders. A great throw, maybe caught the Ohio defense a little by surprise. I know everyone on that Ohio D is focusing on number 1. They come out throwing it.
And they're going to throw it again, and this time it's incomplete. They were looking for Marcus Perez, number 5, a 5'11", 170-pound sophomore. Let's take a look at the Ohio defense. Brought to you by Applebee's, the Ohio defensive starters, Jamison Hartke, Shane Yates, Landon Cohen, and Brett Sykes. Up front, Graham Muncy, Russ are the backers, and there is their defensive backfield.
Very experienced group on defense. 9 starters returning, 3 of them in the secondary.
And Garrett Wolf will touch it, his first carry of the day, turns the corner. Garrett Wolf into the secondary, knocked out. That will be a gain of 8 yards and bring up a 3rd and 2. Tommy, that got pretty good push on that line.
Well, get used to seeing this play. Just a stretch play. He gets his big offensive lineman out in front of him, gets a block from Britt Davis. They like to get Garrett Wolf on the perimeter where he has not only great speed, but he's got great vision. They stretch that play out and allow him to find a seam.
Acevedo with a real good block there.
Very athletic on that offensive line. They can afford to pull their guards, their tackle, and their center at times.
And this time they hand it to Garrett Wolf, and it goes absolutely nowhere. A loss of 2 on the play. And it will bring down a 4th and 4 situation.
Just too much penetration up front. Great play there by Shane Yates, shaking his block.
6'2", 280, a senior, number 74, just blew that play up. So the Huskies will try a field goal. They've got the wind with them. A 47-yard attempt for Chris Nendick. Junior kicker, very solid. Snap, set, kick is no good. Wide right. May have had a little problem on the snap and the set. But Nendick misses. We'll take a timeout. We've got no score in DeKalb.
Advance your career with an MBA from Northern Illinois University.
I was able to balance my MBA with my professional life as well as my personal life. And best of all, NIU's MBA program is AACSB accredited and affordable.
I was impressed with the knowledge and experience of the professors, and the program provided me with a well-rounded business education. The affordability and convenient locations made my decision easy, and it made my MBA a reality.
Designed for the working professional, the MBA program at Northern Illinois University. Jumpstart your career today.
NIU fans, when you enter the Village Commons bookstore, you're entering Husky territory. VCB is the official site for NIU athletics, featuring the new NIU logo on a wide range of hats, t-shirts, shorts, sweats, and NIU logo gifts and accessories. Whether you're a student, graduate, or a fan of NIU athletics, the Village Commons bookstore is your Husky headquarters. Visit us in DeKalb or call us toll-free 800-700-4868 or on the web at www.vcbs.com.
Welcome back. Ohio and Northern Illinois, no score with 11:13 left first quarter. The broadcast rights for this event have been granted to Comcast Sportsnet by Northern Illinois University. Any reproduction or rebroadcast without the expressed written consent of Comcast Sportsnet and NIU is strictly prohibited. Send Tom Waddle over to your house. Take care of you. Austin Everson throws on first down. And he has his big tight end. I believe that was Rudy Sylvan that made the catch. A gain of two, bringing up a second and eight.
Well, when Ohio does throw the football, look for a lot of high percentage passes. Nothing fancy here. Frank Solich wants to grind it out, use that clock, and maybe get himself some 12, 13, 14 play drives put together.
Again, Ohio goes out of the shotgun, single back set. They'll give to Calvin McCray. Nope, they'll fake, and Everson will keep it. Quarterback keeper for Everson. He gains seven, and they'll call it a third and one situation.
Good decision by a veteran quarterback. Little option route. He decides to keep it here.
Real nice fake to McCray. You saw the whole NIU defensive line bite on it.
Absolutely, and they want to establish the run last week against Tennessee Martin, a Division I AA opponent. They only rushed the ball for 62 yards.
This time they'll give it to McCray, and he's going nowhere. Absolutely nowhere. Tim McCarthy, no gain on the play. Tim McCarthy, the middle linebacker, a sophomore, 6 foot 235, and Tommy, he blew it up.
It just comes in, unblocks. Tim McCarthy stuffs that one at the line of scrimmage. And again, the last thing Ohio wanted to do was three and out. Tim McCarthy, just a great, great football player. Nothing flashy about him.
Matt Lasher in the punt. He was the special teams player of the week in the conference last week for his performance. And here is a high drifting kick. It'll be caught, fair caught, and Northern will take it. A 34-yard punt for Ohio. Let's take a look at the weather conditions here today in DeKalb. A little hazy, 72 degrees. You see the winds, 12 to 17 miles per hour. There is a chance of some rain here today.
It's not going to come until about 4 or 4:30.
Thank you there.
You're welcome.
Tom Skilling, famous weatherman. Were you comfortable playing in these conditions? Did you like it cooler, warmer, what, when you played?
As long as it wasn't raining and it wasn't 15 below, I was okay with it.
You didn't like those chilly climates?
No, I don't think anybody did.
Horvath hands to Garrett Wolf. Wolf cracks his way through. I believe he's picked up a first down. Yes, a gain of 11, and the chains will move.
This play designed again to maybe bounce outside, but he sees a great seam, gets a block in front by Matt Rogers. And Garrett Wolf does such a great job despite his diminutive size, about 5'7", 177 pounds, does a great job banging it between the tackles.
He just never keeps stop moving his feet.
surprisingly, this young man can carry it 35, 40 times a game and remain healthy week in and week out.
His legs are always churning. First and 10 at the 37. They give to Wolf again. And he is smacked after a gain of 1 yard.
Well, right now, Ohio's having some success despite that last play. Stopping at the middle, you have a new center in Eddie Adamski and Chris Acevedo at your left guard. See a great play by Tyler Russ, the weak side linebacker, steps in and makes the stop. You lose a quality center like Brian Van Acker to graduation. You're going to have to learn your way in the middle of that offensive line.
Tyler Russ, as you said, the man that came up and put the big hit on Wolf. This time Horvath's going to throw. He's got time. He's flushed. He's looking. He throws. Has his man. And he's got a first down and more. First down, Northern Illinois. Marcus Perez makes the catch. A gain of 22.
You see right there the reason why Phil Horvath was the most efficient quarterback in Division I college football last season prior to hurting himself. Doesn't make a mistake. Doesn't throw the ball into traffic, waits to find somebody open, and again you get a great block. Matt Rogers, a veteran guard, steps up and cleans a pile. Horvath does a nice job finding Marcus Perez, who had snuck it flat.
And they'll give it to Garrett Wolf. Wolf trying to pick his way, and he will be turned back at the 35 after a gain of 5 yards. Tony Ward, number 6, 5'11", 198-pound junior, came up and turned it back at the 35. As you look at his numbers last week versus number 1 Ohio State.
And the big number there, 6.6 yards per rush.
Against the best team in America.
And if you can believe it, his time with the Northern Illinois Huskies, he has averaged 6.6 yards per carry, which is unbelievable over the course of a career.
That's amazing. Horvath fakes to Wolf. He throws. He's got his big man. Brandon Davis, 6'4", 261, a junior. And they go to a double tight end set. He is always in there. Gain of 14 yards for Horvath.
Well, these types of routes are going to be open when you run the football effectively. Brandon Davis just slips underneath the coverage. A good play fake. You see the offensive line sells the run. Phil Horvath, once again, very accurate with his throw.
Joe Novak told us that they had a very good week of practice. They give it to Garrett Wolf. He bounces it outside. Give him 6. Touchdown, Northern Illinois. 21 yards to Pater, and the Huskies jump on top, 6-0. Tommy, that was a big-time run.
Well, you just saw why he is a legitimate Heisman candidate, as we talked about in the open. He's got great vision. He finds a hole once again. His offensive line out in front of him, giving him some creases. And right there, he just turns on the speed. 4.3 in a 40-yard dash. The kid has got tremendous talent.
Chris Nendick has made 94 straight. Make it 95 straight PATs. And it's a 7-0 lead for the Huskies. 6:35 to go. First quarter, Garrett Wolf, 38 rushing yards on that drive alone. And the Huskies have a 7-0 lead. We'll take a timeout. We'll come back for the kickoff. Huskies 7, Bobcats nothing on Comcast SportsNet.
My wife works hard. The kids are 10, 6, and 3. Our life together gets a little crazy. So I called Applebee's like I've done before. They brought our favorite foods out to my car door.
With Applebee's Carside to Go, you call it in, we bring it out.
Now my wife runs to meet me just as fast as she can, cause there's something women like about a pickup man.
Applebee's Carside to Go. It's not fast food, it's Applebee's food fast.
On the next of Nima Nera, for Latin American baseball players, adjusting to American culture can be hard.
Es difícil cuando llega a este país y te sientas y no sabes qué carrizo.
But the success of Ozzie Guillen and others continues to provide inspiration.
Eso le sirve para los jovencitos que están empezando ahora a jugar este béisbol, que en la vida todo es posible.
Ami Manera, presented by your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Chevy dealers and United Auto Insurance Group. Sunday only on Comcast Sportsnet. Bears fans, when the game is over, turn to U.S. Cellular Bears Postgame Live for in-depth postgame coverage. our All-Pro crew breaks down all the excitement, complete with player grades and expert analysis. Plus, we're live outside the locker room with instant player reactions, inside the press room for all the post-game news conferences, and we'll have a preview of the next big matchup for the Monsters of the Midway. U.S. Cellular Bears post-game live after every Bears game, only on Comcast Sportsnet.
Welcome back to Brigham Field at Husky Stadium. It's time for the NIU Alumni Game Scoring Summary. Take a look at that drive, Tom.
Pretty simple, a couple high percentage passes and a whole lot of Garrett Wolf. Expect him to get to the perimeter of that Ohio defense a whole lot this afternoon.
Let's go down to the field. Our sideline man is Jim Blaney.
David, thank you very much. As the Northern Illinois offense came off the field, the guy who was getting the biggest pats in the back was Marcus Perez. He threw a beautiful block on the outside to allow Garrett Wolf to go right down the sideline. And as Tom Waddle knows, if you're going to have an effective running game, the guys on the outside had better mind their blocks. Back to you.
All right, thank you, Jim. Nendick's kick, end over end, about 6 yards deep in the end zone, and Ohio will take it first and 10 at their own 20.
Good to see Jim recognize that I was a crushing blocker in my time.
He must be confusing you with Dennis McKinnon.
He must be. Silky dig and flat knock some people out. You see Frank Solich right there. Can't be happy with the way his offense has played to this point.
Frank was the longtime coach at Nebraska, second season as the Bobcats head coach.
As I said in the open, too, I mean, listen, they're not going to try to out-scheme you. Frank Solich is going to come out and try to punch you right in the mouth, run the football, play good defense. And right now, not real sure what the Bobcats are doing, spread things out.
Frank was a fabulous player in his career. He and Joe Novak have history, having played against one another in Ohio prep football. And then Frank, get this, 145-pound All-American at fullback at Nebraska.
That's a tough man there. That is a tough man.
Gain of six on that play. It'll be a second and four for Ohio. Calvin McCray is the deep man. Single back set. Fake to McCray, they'll throw the football. Ohio's gonna have a first down, their first down of the afternoon, as Rudy Sylvan catches his second ball for a gain of 11. Austin Everson hit him, and he just did the rest with his feet to get the first down.
Once again, you see the benefit of running the football effectively. The nice play fake to Calvin McCray. Austin Everson gets it out to his big target, and they move the chains.
First and 10 at the 37. Again out of the shotgun. Looks to be a bit of a broken play, and it goes absolutely nowhere. That one did not work the way they drew it up. No gain on the play. What happened, Tom?
Didn't look like the offensive line knew the snap count.
No gain on the play for Ohio.
It looked like Calvin McCray may, the quarterback may have thought McCray was supposed to take a handoff. McCray said no.
Yeah, and Austin Everson did the right thing. Protected the football. Got down as quick as possible.
Yeah, you just don't want to take a big hit where you caught the football. Second and 10 at the 37. Empty backfield. Everson looking, throwing, going down the field. Got his man. That one's going to go to the house for the Bobcats. Touchdown, William Norwood, 63 yards.
Free safety Dustin Utchick is going to absolutely be sick to his stomach tomorrow when he sees this in the film room. He just takes a horrible angle. It's a good decision. It was a bit of a floater. Norwood finds a seam, and right there, just a bad angle by Utchick. Good decision looking up, and look at that. That is a quail. Good job by Norwood to find the ball, get it into the end zone.
Extra point is up, and it is perfect for Matt Lasher, and we are even at seven on a 63-yard touchdown.
I just think that Utchick thought that he was going to be able to step up and pick this pass off, and the ball hangs. Just a bad decision by the free safety. Much like golf, there are no pictures on scorecards. No one's going to look at this tomorrow and say, what a horrible throw. It obviously found its target, but
Dustin Upchick saw interception
he
all
did.
The way.
And the ball just hung in the air a little longer than I thought. I think he thought it would.
And it works out. William Norwood takes it and does it with his legs after the catch. Outruns the NIU defense for the touchdown. Norwood is a senior, 6'1", 215. He's from close to this area, Racine, Wisconsin.
I think the Northern defense came in today and said, hey, listen, we're going to focus on shutting down this Bobcat running attack. And if they beat us through the air, then they beat us through the air. Unfortunately for Joe Novak, they just beat him through the air right there.
Exactly right. You know that Ohio had 28 yards before that play. They get 63 on one pass.
They had 144 total yards last week against Tennessee Martin.
They get the big play, and this one's going to come down to Marcus Perez. Marcus Perez finds a seam. Marcus Perez across the 30. Marcus Perez tripped up by the kicker Lasher with an outstanding tackle. Otherwise, that one may be gone for six. 41 yards on the return, but great, great play by the kicker, Matt Lasher. To the field we go, to Jim Blaney.
All right, David, thank you very much. You talk about a big difference down here on the field. Up until that touchdown by Ohio, their bench, they were starting to feel like, oh, no, here goes Northern Illinois. But all of a sudden, they get that touchdown, and the demeanor of this bench totally changed. Guys coming off the field saying, hey, we're right there with these guys, and we're right in this. Back to you.
All right, Jimmy, back to action. Horvath goes to the air, finds his big tight end, and it'll be a gain of 8, bringing up a second and 2 as Jake Nordine makes the catch.
I think Marcus Perez would be wise to sit next to Dustin Upchick tomorrow in films. Dustin's going to be sick at the angle he took, and Marcus is going to get razzed for being brought down by the kicker. You don't ever let a kicker take you down an open field.
Real good tackle.
He's a kicker.
I was a kicker. We kickers can hit. Hand off Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf. Maybe go to the house. Yes, he is. Touchdown, NIU. Give him 6. 46 yards for Garrett Wolf. And just like that, they're back up 13-7 with a PAT to follow, Tom.
Nothing like breaking the spirit of a team that just scored. Once again, they bring it right up the gut. Guard to guard, Northern is having a great afternoon blocking Garrett Wolf in the open field. No one's going to catch him.
Well, Todd Kanan thought he had him, and all of a sudden his shoes went one way, his body went the other. Garrett Wolf was gone.
Garrett doesn't look like he's moving real fast at times, but he does have that extra gear when he needs it.
Nendick's extra point is good, and it's back to a 7-point lead. 14-7 Huskies. We've just seen 3 TDs in 3:28, and you're watching the best back in America. He's just hit pay dirt twice. We'll come right back. Got a doozy going on Comcast SportsNet.
For over 50 years, Blaine's Farm and Fleet has been supplying families with all kinds of quality goods at low prices. And for those big bags of supplies you need for everyday life, no other store offers more. At Farm and Fleet, you'll find water softener salt, a big selection of food for your pets, lots of food for the birds, and their extensive line of agricultural feeds and supplements. You'll appreciate their tradition of convenience, quality, and value. For big bags and more, Blaine's Farm and Fleet is your store.
A lot of car companies rigorously inspect their pre-owned vehicles. But no matter how hard they look, the one thing they'll never find is this. Drive with your heart. Buy with your head. Certified pre-owned by BMW. Only at your authorized BMW center.
14-7 Northern Illinois over Ohio. A lot of fireworks. 3:07 still to go in the first. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle, and Jim Blaney with you in DeKalb. There's some pretty good company right there, Tom.
I would say so. I think he's going to move up that list fairly quickly.
Well, he's about to go by Alan Ross.
Well, and it won't take long for him to get past Mark Keller either.
Can he catch Michael Turner remains to be seen.
I think that Garrett's probably got 1,800 yard season in him. Yeah, I think so.
Then he probably gets
seven carries, 90 yards already. Unbelievable.
Another deep kick, and this one again will be down in the end zone. So Ohio will take over first and 10 at their own 20. The NIU Alumni Association scoring summary of that drive. Two plays, 54 yards, took a minute 14. Wolf did the honors again. His last two carries for touchdowns, and there you saw the big run.
Don't blink, you may miss him.
That's exactly right.
It's another ho-hum touchdown for one of the best backs in college football.
Wow. And remember, we were here years ago when he wasn't even a starter.
No.
And he got into the games with an injury.
Playing behind A.J. Harris, correct?
Correct. First and 10, nearly a bad snap, corralled by Emerson. And a gain of 5 for Ohio. Josh Abrams was the man who carried the football, but a real nice job by Austin Everson to haul in a high snap.
He may have the best hands on the team so far today.
Second down 5 from the 25.
You see Dustin Hutchick there.
Made a mistake. Stay away from one of his position coaches.
He made a mistake in the last drive, but this young man's a talented football player. Led the MAC in tackles last year.
There's a handoff. Calvin McCray picking his way. Calvin McCray will gain. They're going to call it 4. Maybe 5.
Expect a lot of this as Calvin comes off and needs to get the shoe put back on. But expect a lot of misdirection running of the football today from Ohio. They want to control the clock, and obviously, as you saw a few plays ago, they want to keep number one in the red uniform off the field.
Third and 1. Crowd into it. Quarterback sneak. And I think he gains 2 yards, and they will call it a first down.
Well, when you're all
a pretty good push,
your all conference running back leaves with a bad shoe, you have to think that the next guy up to get the ball is going to be your quarterback. They get a good push up front. And Ohio converts the third down.
Now here's where we see the rule change this year, because the ball's been spot. It's been spotted ready for play, so the clock rolls. Normally last year, the rule was not till it snapped did you run the time again.
And you will see a quarterback change right now for Ohio. The youngster from Burr Ridge,
that's
Brad Bauer,
Brad
is under center.
Is now in. They will use different looks at quarterback. We have a stoppage in play. There is no yellow laundry. We get a timeout for Ohio.
This is going to be a problem for teams this year. As you see, Austin Everson looks like he needs to run into the locker room.
But they told us before the game that we would see Bauer today.
Yes. But the point I was making is I think you're going to see some of this confusion in terms of managing the clock correctly with some of the time changes that have come up about with the rule changes. I think you are going to see some confusion at times, and I think you're going to see some delay of games that didn't exist last year.
You will see, they say, as many as 20 fewer plays in a college football game this year.
So, and hence, I think what you're going to see from a lot of high-powered offenses over the course of the year is a lot of no-huddle offense, so that they can replace those misplays just by not going into the huddle more frequently.
And as Steve Spurrier said, he believes you'll see more underdogs shocking people because the explosive offenses, as you say, won't get as many opportunities to put people away. Tomorrow, get a complete recap of the Bears-Packers showdown on U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live. Pat Boyle, Richard Dent, Jerry Azuma, and Dan Jiggets will break down all the action. William Jackson will bring you interviews with all the players as they leave the locker room. U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live tomorrow, immediately after the Bears game, only right here on Comcast Sports.
Poor
Net.
Brett Favre. I think he may be running for his life tomorrow. And I say that, poor Brett Favre is a former Bear, because I have tremendous respect for him. But they're starting 2 rookie guards on the offensive line. I think Brett may have a long day against that Bear defense.
We're being told Austin Everson is. Ohio tries a fake double reverse. They go reverse. It goes absolutely nowhere. Husky defense not fooled at all.
And when you're not a high-powered offense, you cannot afford many negative plays, and this is a negative play.
Loss of five on the play. Brandon Bice, redshirt freshman, 6'3", 236, blew it up, did a real nice job. Looked like a real good fake on the double reverse, and then nobody on the Husky side bit on it.
Well, as you said earlier, Joe Novak talked to us before the game, said they had a great week of practice. A lot of that is film study. Looks like they had that play smothered from the beginning.
Bauer throws, he completes it, finds his man, and a big, big hit for Mark Ryder, number 8, absolutely lit up Justin Fitzgerald. Watch this hit again.
It's a nice little swing route. This will clear your cobwebs if you have both guys. Get a nice audio version.
Oh. Wow. The corner has come to an end. It'll bring up a 3rd and 7 when we come back.
I'm going to go lay down because that just brought back some really bad memories.
Tampa Bay, maybe?
To name a few.
14-7 Huskies over Bobcats on Comcast SportsNet.
NIU, serving the heart of America's heartland. Educating new leaders for the nation's third largest region. Bringing expertise and innovation to communities and public schools. Creating new jobs and new workers. Conducting research that improves our quality of life. Northern Illinois University. Across the region, from Chicago to the Mississippi, NIU works.
Ask a few of your friends what they thought after having LASIK eye surgery at the Hauser Ross Eye Institute.
Yeah.
And you might hear something like this.
Yeah, it's one of those things that until afterward, I don't know how I got along without it.
You know, my biggest question for my doctor at Hauser Ross was, why did I wait so long to do this?
Find out why so many people have trusted the Hauser Ross Eye Institute for LASIK eye surgery. Call 1-800-CHECKUP today.
Are you ready for new windows and siding? Just call Empire today. Our triple pane windows feature self-cleaning glass and a lifetime limited glass breakage warranty. Our vinyl siding is energy efficient and maintenance free. You can trust Empire today for professional installation in just 2 weeks. You'll save with warehouse direct prices, plus make no payments till 2008. So if you are thinking about new windows or siding, we're ready when you are. Call Empire today.
800-588-2300-EMPIRE.
Today.
This broadcast of Northern Illinois Husky football on Comcast SportsNet is brought to you by U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Fatty's Bar and Grill, the official tailgate home of NIU Athletics. Village Commons Bookstore, for all your Husky clothing and souvenirs, visit vcbs.com. Applebee's, try Applebee's Car Side Go. You call it in, we bring it out. Casey's General Stores, the official convenience store of NIU Athletics. Casey's, a convenience store and a whole lot more. Blaine's Farm and Fleet, I found it at Farm and Fleet. The NIU MBA programs, take the NIU MBA Challenge. The NIU Alumni Association, stay connected with NIU. And Kishwaukee Hospital.
While you were away, Northern Illinois called for a defensive pass interference.
I believe, who are they going to get, Mark Ryder on that penalty?
He was a little extra jazzed.
Defensive pass interference. Spot foul, automatic first down.
A little overzealous after the big hit last time.
Correct. He hit Tito Noacocha. That's the first penalty on Northern Illinois.
You know, as Coach Ditka used to tell us, son, some days you're the bug, other days you're the windshield.
Is that what he said?
Sure. I just unfortunately spent way too much of my career as the bug.
Bauer still in at quarterback in relief of Austin Everson. And a big hit laid on number 5, Calvin McCray, by Mark Ryder again. He's been all over the place. There's a look at first quarter stats.
Yeah, again, the big play, the touchdown pass to William Norwood for Ohio, and it's all Garrett Wolf for Northern Illinois. Time of possession, a little misleading. Already 150 yards from the Husky offense.
Gain of three on that play, second and seven. Brad Bauer out of Burr Ridge, Illinois. Transfer from the University of Illinois. And Bauer to the air, incomplete. He was looking for his big tight end, Rudy Sylvan.
Just didn't set his feet. And that's going to happen to a quarterback that steps in after sitting on the sideline for the first quarter.
You want to know some interesting symmetry between these two schools?
Love to.
Dan Castellaneta, the voice of Homer Simpson, is a Northern Illinois graduate.
I did not know that.
Nancy Cartwright, the voice of Bart Simpson, is an Ohio graduate.
You are the king of pop culture.
That's me, buddy. Third down and seven for Ohio. Bauer to the air, looking, dumps it off to McCray, and McCray will be, see where they spot him. Did he get the first down? Is he knocked out of bounds? And he's going to be short.
Well, they're going to spot him out of bounds about the 42-yard line.
Let's go down to Jim Blaney on the sideline. Jim.
All right, David. On Austin Everson went into the locker room for just a moment and came right back out when he came out of the game. He hasn't been getting looked at by the trainers. He has his helmet, so he's just on the sidelines right now, ready to go if they need him. But on the other hand, Chino Wachoka, he came off the sidelines, and let's just put it this way, lunch made a reappearance, so he's going to be on the sidelines for a couple of minutes, but it looks like he may be able to go back in. Back to you.
All right, thank you, Jimmy.
Thanks lunch, for that visual.
Lunch made a reappearance.
That.
Thanks a lot. Marcus Perez will field last year's punt. Perez evades one man. Perez turns a corner and then is swarmed under by a sea of green and white.
Just delaying the inevitable right there.
Another great punt. 48 yards and a return of seven. You look at Joe Novak.
Certainly got to be happy with the way his offense is moving the football.
Let me give you some numbers on Joe Novak, his 11th season as the Huskies head coach, and you see 54-61. Don't forget there was a lengthy 23-game losing streak to start. Since that time, in 10 seasons since, 32-23 at home. They've won 31 of their last 37. Here in DeKalb, 15-2 at home since the beginning of the 0-3 season for an 88% winning percentage. Gain of four, by the way, on that play. Second and six, there are both QBs.
Sharing an air sickness bag.
And taking phone calls.
Tyler Russ, you just saw a moment ago, do something not many defenders in college football have been able to do, and that's bring Garrett Wolf down all by himself.
Huskies have not lost more than one MAC home game in any of the last seven seasons. Talk about building a program. Joe Novak has done just that. Horvath throws, finds his man. Jared Carter makes the catch. It's a gain of five. It'll bring up a third and one. Let's take a look at some more Joe Novak numbers. 8-36 to get it rolling. He took over a program that was completely buried. Since then, 37-20, MAC Coach of the Year, won a bowl game, MAC title game in 05, and picked to win it this year.
And the one thing missing from that resume, which I know Joe is hot after, a MAC title.
They are picked to win it this year, and Garrett Wolf will. That'll bring up a fourth down, a loss of one on the play.
Just a jailbreak up front, a full blitz. That's a big time hit by Michael Mitchell. Coming up from the strong safety position.
You know, they're fired up.
They've had tremendous success attacking the middle of that Ohio defense at times, and at other times, that inexperienced guard to guard tandem of the Huskies offensive line, they've struggled. There's been inconsistent play.
Andy Dittbenner in the punt. Punt is away. It'll be a long driving kick. And a fair catch right around the 30-yard line. That will be a 45-yard kick into the wind. Real good punt for Dittbenner. We'll take a timeout. 14-7 Huskies.
Husky fans, Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb is your official pre- and post-game NIU football headquarters. Whether you're catching a game on our big screens or having some of our famous grilled food out in our beer garden, Fatty's is the place to be. Join us on September 9th for our season kickoff outdoor tent party. And don't forget the Fatty's Ultimate Tailgate at the University of Iowa. For more information, log on to fattyspub.com. It's all at Fatty's Pub and Grill, located directly south of Husky Stadium on Route 38 in DeKalb.
At Jewel, it's the fresh way we trim, slice, serve, the fresh way we grind, prepare, fish. It's offering the freshest variety, the best poultry, beef, pork, seafood that's oh so fresh, and help from our experts in store. Top quality, great service, all fresh to your family from Jewel.
6,800 or online at NIU Husky.
Good crowd on hand here at Brigham Field at Husky Stadium.
NIU t-shirt.
You know, down at the obviously open bar at that fraternity. So down at the north end zone, there's a brand new building going up. We'll get you a shot of that when we can. They call it the Academic and Athletic Performance Center. And they broke ground. You see it right there. It's going to be an absolutely phenomenal facility. Athletic director and vice president at the university, Jim Phillips, has done just an unbelievable job in his 2 years here at breaking ground there and coming up with some amazing. And then a football loose, stripped from behind from McCray by Kenny West in Northern Illinois, comes up with it. Corey Hansen fell on it, and the Huskies take over in excellent field position.
Just a beautifully designed play as well. Austin Everson sells the pass, drops back the little shovel pass to Calvin McCray, who finds the seam and then just doesn't take care of the football. Ken West, nice job stripping it. But again, you can't go on the road against a team with, I think we would all say, with some superior talent, turn the football over.
Certainly not your end of the football field. Phil Horvath with his single back set gives it to Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf turns the corner and he is smacked right around the 42 or 43 yard line. A little extracurricular activities.
Well, you see the strength of Garrett Wolf right there. That was a tremendous hit by Michael Mitchell, but ultimately it was Mitchell who landed on his back.
Watch number one. He's 5'7". He turns the corner right there, and then he gets
bang.
Hit there.
But look at the leg strength. And look at the, you know, when they talk about core strength in your hips and in your midsection,
Garrett Wolf has it.
Garrett Wolf has it, despite being 5'7 and 180 pounds. You see Michael Mitchell, 6'1, 207 or thereabouts. And I'm not so sure that Mitchell didn't take the brunt of it at the end.
Gain of four, second and six. Horvath gonna throw. Horvath's going down the field, got a man, and he dropped it. Marcus Perez had himself six, and he just couldn't tuck it away. A perfect throw from Phil Horvath right in his hands, and it just wasn't to be.
Again, Horvath does a great job showing patience, steps up in the pocket, and just throws it right on the money. And as you saw at the very end, Marcus Perez looks like he takes his eyes off the ball. There is a bit of wind, but that certainly is not an excuse.
He knows it, should have had it. A third and five now. Horvath to the air again, steps up, gets a little pressure, rolls, throws, and he's got his man. He's got his man, Jake Nordine. Makes the grab for a Husky first down and a gain of 19.
Pretty athletic play by a big tight end, but again, I've talked about it a lot today. Horvath, a veteran quarterback, not making mistakes and throws it perfect strike. Nordine does a great job catching the football, getting a foot down, and converting a big third down.
Says, Marcus, I'll pick you up, buddy. Did you ever have one of those where you hit six and it just slipped through your fingers?
Happens to everybody.
Horvath to Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf trying to turn the corner, picking his way. Boy, he's just hard to bring down.
He is. He's slippery. He's got great vision.
He's got two on that.
Strength. And again, they're trying to attack the perimeter of that Ohio defense. Not a whole lot there.
Does he remind you of anybody in the NFL?
Boy, Dave Meggett at all? Maybe Dave Meggett size-wise. I tell you, Garrett Wolf's about as strong for his size as anyone I've ever seen put pads on.
See Garrett Wolf, the single back set. Fake to Wolf, Horvath rolling. Horvath looking, he's gonna run out of bounds.
Senior move.
Good solid play by the Ohio defense.
And a great decision by Horvath. You're in plus territory, a place you need to come away with points, whether it's a touchdown or a field goal. Nordine's not open. Horvath just does the wise thing.
Garrett Wolf, the leading returning rusher in the nation, averaged 175.6 a year ago, 200.2 all-purpose yards per game, and named to the very prestigious Playboy All-American team. First Husky to ever get that honor. And Horvath was belted down. I think he took a shot.
He had Britt Davis running all by himself up the numbers.
That one was intended for Jared Carter.
You see Britt Davis come a little wheel route. Nobody around him, but obviously Phil Horvath had somebody in his face. Sure, he'll go back to Phil and say, hey, why don't we try that play one more time and see if we can get a different result.
Chris Nendick from 36 yards. Snap, set, kick, sails through the uprights, and it is perfect. Points off the turnover, and the Huskies grab a 17-7 lead. And Nendick, the junior, one of the better kickers you'll see.
Joe Novak probably not real excited about the field goal now. You had an opportunity with Marcus Perez for the touchdown. You had another opportunity with Britt Davis running all by himself down the sideline. Obviously, you want the points. But when you get the chance to get the ball in the end zone and get six, you have to come away with the touchdowns.
Here's a look at the Ohio Bobcats sideline. Their head coach, Frank Solich, that we said earlier in the game, an All-American fullback at 145. That's how the game has changed, because you'd never get a chance now to play it that way.
I don't think there's probably, maybe there's a few kickers. I don't believe, though, any positional players on any Division I roster are weighing 145.
Let alone a fullback.
Right.
Making All-American.
Well, you just hope his Bobcat team approaches
the game the way he
or mimics his approach to the game. And that's hard-nosed with tremendous discipline.
And Tom's notes just blew out of the booth as we give you the NIU Alumni Association scoring drive. 7 plays, 22 yards. It took 216. Nendick, a 36-yard field goal. Those weren't your important notes.
I don't have any important notes. And B, most of the things I write, I can't read anyway. I draw pictures on most of my stuff.
I was talking to Donna Turner, the new associate athletic director and runs the sports information officer, replacing Mike Corsick, the Hall of Famer, who's retired and is now SID Emeritus here. And we're going over some of the names and some of the notes, and I'm trying to read my own handwriting. The kickoff comes down right around the 12-yard line. Scott Mayo grabs it and runs it out to about the 22. Again, they're going to call it 13 yards on the return, and Ohio will go on the attack. First and 10. See where they're spotting this. The 25-yard line.
And the Bobcats need to get something going right now. They have the wind with them on this drive. They had a great opportunity. Unfortunately, Calvin McCray just fumbled the football after a 9-yard gain on their last possession.
Austin Everson is back in at quarterback, number 9. Hands it off to Abrams, who drives his legs, and it'll be blown dead right around the 31-yard line. A gain of 6, they're going to call it. 2nd and 4.
I'd like to eat a little bit of the clock right now. Keep that Northern Illinois offense off the field. Wear down the front four of the Huskies. Try to establish a little bit of momentum of their own. You see, once again, Ohio having trouble running the football or establishing the run today.
Hand off. Pick up about three. Von Kerry Owens, number 20, his first carry of the day. Senior tailback at 5'10".
Von Kerry Owens, the ball carrier for Ohio.
You see Ohio now attacking very active with the very light perimeter of the Northern defense.
Third and one situation after a gain of three.
Ken West, very active player on the edge, but still 6'1", 243. Larry English on the side, only 236, so.
Huskies, as Tommy told you, an attack 4-3. And that play, oh, nearly sacked, incomplete. That one was blown up in the backfield, and they missed the sack. Alva Hansborough had it.
I don't know how Austin Everson kept his feet. Just a quarter blitz from Hansborough. Nice play fake, and the play was open. Everson just gets the ball up, but can't set his feet and get it to his tight end.
Last year, we'll be in the punt again. Throw Tommy on third and one. Does that say we have no confidence in the running game or just trying to go with a surprise?
Well, I'm a little surprised they didn't.
Marcus Perez fields the punt.
No, I'm with you. I'm a little surprised they just didn't buckle their chin straps and try to get the yard and extend the drive.
51 yards on the punt, 5 on the return, 17-7 when we come back with 6:40 to go in the second.
The verdict is in. The College of Law at Northern Illinois University is one of the nation's most respected law schools. At NIU Law, top students are part of a tight-knit, dynamic, and diverse learning community. Small classes give them unmatched access to some of the best legal scholars in the country, and state-of-the-art technology prepares them for today's courtrooms. Many NIU Law students even get hands-on legal practice before they graduate. That's why so many successful lawyers and judges hold degrees from the NIU College of Law. NIU Law. Discover the difference.
Want more than just the score? Then log on to ComcastSportsNet.com. Read analysis from Comcast SportsNet's experts that you can't find anywhere else. Get up to the second news headlines. See the day's programming lineup. Check out talent bios and watch video clips featuring the latest info on your teams. Plus, sign up for Sports Extra and Sports Blast email alerts that make you the first to know about breaking news. So what are you waiting for? Log on to ComcastSportsNet.com right now. Bears fans, when the game is over, turn to U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live for in-depth post-game coverage. Our all-pro crew breaks down all the excitement, complete with player grades and expert analysis. Plus, we're live outside the locker room with instant player reactions, inside the press room for all the post-game news conferences, and we'll have a preview of the next big matchup for the Monsters of the Midway. U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live after every Bears game, only on Comcast SportsNet.
Welcome back, Husky Stadium. The NIU defense on the sidelines talking about the ebb and flow of this game. It certainly looked like in the early going like the Northern offense was going to blow Ohio off the field. But we all know from watching football that offense, there tends to be an ebb and flow. But what the defense is talking about is keeping up the pressure, keeping up the heat, staying consistent, and they know the offense will get a kick back into gear. David, back to you.
Thanks, Jimmy. Horvath to the air, finds Marcus Perez enough to move the chains. A gain of 12 on the play. Garrett Wolf, do you think he's tired at all? 90 yards in the first quarter.
No, I don't
only
think he's
9 yards on his last 4 carries.
No, he's not tired. He just hasn't gotten the cooperation from his offensive line, particularly in the center of that offensive line. As I said, this young man, for being 5'7" and 175 pounds, he can run all day. You give it to him 40 times today, and I don't think he'd be tired by the end of the game.
Well, he's going to get one of those 40 right here. Wolf trying to turn the corner, and he's knocked out of bounds.
Run made by number one.
Yeah, he didn't get a real good block from Britt Davis on the edge.
We'll call it a gain of 5, second and 5.
Gain of 4 yards.
Well, he's certainly going to have a bullseye on his back the entire year, and defenses are going to come in with a game plan to slow him down and slow him down first, and Phil Horvath's going to have to step up and make some plays at times. But the offense is going to run right through number one.
Garrett Wolf gets the handoff here, picks his way across the 35. A gain of three, gain of two.
And you just saw one of the subtle things that make him such a great back. A defensive player shooting a gap. Looks like he's got Garrett down in the backfield, and he just has got such great balance and great vision. One little quick step, and that defender misses.
Todd Koenig came up and laid the hit on him. It's a third and four situation. Horvath going to throw, quick throw, and he misses his man, Britt Davis. Pass sails out of bounds, and that will mean the Huskies will punt the football away with 5:06 to go in the second quarter. David Kaplan, Tom Waddell, and Jim Blaney with you here in DeKalb. Feel football weather in the air. A little bit chillier than we've had.
What's here? Most wonderful time of the year. The NFL season, week one, begins tomorrow. Well, I guess it began on Thursday with Pittsburgh's win, but for the most part, begins on Sunday.
Chris Garrett, the deep man, did better to punt, gets it away, and it's a short kick. It's going to take a Husky roll, and it's going to roll dead right around the 31-yard line, a 32-yard kick.
I hate to use this word because of my love of golf.
I was hoping
but
you
this
would
right
use
here
it.
Is called a shank.
Not what he wanted.
But with the football season upon us and my golf clubs put away in the closet, I think I can get away with saying it, not giving myself the.
Why do I not believe your clubs are put away for the year?
They are. I said it last time, I'll say it again. Ohio needs a sustained drive.
And they've got an I formation. McCray, the tail of the tandem, gets the handoff with a big fullback out in front of him. And McCray picks his way for a gain of five, second and five. Adriel Hansbrough, number 12, the man that made the tackle. Jason White, I believe, was in at fullback on that play.
Leading the way for his tailback, Calvin McCray. Again, they'd like to control this clock from here to the end of the first half and possibly come away with some points.
Austin Everson at quarterback.
They just don't want to give Garrett Wolf another opportunity to carry the ball.
And that is a real good throw. William Norwood, who caught the long touchdown earlier, makes the catch. A gain of 11 and a first down for the Ohio Bobcats.
Just a nice job reading the defense. He feels the zone, sits down, a good delivery from Austin Everson. I think this Cat team, both offensively and defensively, starting to find a rhythm a little bit.
Handed to McCray, and that one's going to be bottled up quickly by the interior of that NIU line. I think Keenan Blaylock was among the guys in there that made the tackle, plus Tim McCarthy and Corey Hansen.
I'm going to tell you this. The Bobcats are going to run that play a few more times. The Huskies are going to over-pursue, and they did a great job pursuing there, but Everson's going to keep that ball and run to daylight and have himself a real big game. Because right now, this Northern defense is really not respecting Austin Everson as a runner.
Gain of one on the play, a second and nine with an empty backfield. McCray now split out wide. Everson to the air, throws, and he's got his man. Football came out, but I think the officials are going to say that he was down. Justin Riley made the catch.
Another example of a receiver finding a seam. Austin Everson, a nice job finding his receiver. Goes through his progression. Ball comes out late, that's not a fumble, but once again, the Bobcats find themselves in third and short.
Third and two, Brown again gets into it.
And they're controlling the clock at this point as well, which is what they wanted to do.
Everson to the air.
He's got room.
Flips it out to McCray, who's got a lot of room, and he runs out of bounds around the 36-yard line, 34-yard line, I think they're going to mark it. A gain of 12, a well-executed play, Tom.
Well, this was the Bobcat offense we were expecting. Run the football, and a controlled passing game. And again, when you have success between the tackles, running the ball, things are going to open up in your passing game. They did a great job attacking the perimeter of that Husky defense.
Again, out of the gun. They've moved it to the 34. They'll give it to McCray, and he cracks into the secondary for a very nice gain of 8. They are running the ball very effectively.
Yes, they are. This is the type of drive Frank Solich wanted to see from his offense. Again, just attacking the center of the Husky defense, McCray. Good, strong runner.
Everson looking, looking, hit as he throws, and he's got his man. That was a great throw with a lot of pressure on it.
And that play's made possible by Calvin McCray, the tailback who just ran the football, steps up, picks up Larry English on the rush. Right there, you see on the corner of your screen, and Austin Everson again with a nice high percentage completion, or a nice high percentage pass.
Hansbrough, Alva Hansbrough on the tackle.
And the clock continues to roll. They're in no rush right now. They do not want to give the football back to a quick strike Husky offense.
Everson looking, looking, throws, and misses his man. Says to himself, God, how did I miss him? He was wide open. 1:04 to go, second quarter. Very good football game. You look at Frank Solich, the head man at Ohio University.
They're going to win at Ohio. It may take him some time to get his kids in the program, his style of player. But Frank Solich had tremendous success at Nebraska. I believe he was fired after a 9-3 season.
That's correct.
Which is pretty hard to believe. Good decision by Solich here as well. His tailback, Calvin McCray, a little gassed. Austin Everson also a little confused what was sent in. I think this was a good decision by Solich.
The ninth play of this drive is coming up after we take this time out on Comcast SportsNet.
Hey, Husky fans, shop online for all the latest Husky merchandise at naubookstore.niu.edu. We carry the best brands, Gear, JanSport, Russell, Vantage, Zephyr, and more. Shop any of our three locations, the Home Student Center, the Convocation Center, and our newest location at the Barsima Alumni and Visitor Center, open 3 hours before game time for every home game. For the best Husky gear selection and prices, stop by today or shop online at niubookstore.niu.edu. That's niubookstore.niu.edu.
Lots has changed over four generations, but one thing that's remained the same is the great taste of Rosani's Pizza. For 40 years, the Rosani family's secret recipes have kept people coming back for more. Authentic pizzas are made by hand, always with the freshest homemade sauce and ingredients. Deep dish, thin crust, there's something for everyone. Or dive into the cheap, delicious Italian beef with melted mozzarella. Rosani's Pizza, a tradition of quality for four generations. Log on to myrosani's.com to find the location near you.
17-7, ninth play of the drive coming up. It's the battle of the bands here at halftime. There's a lot of great high school bands here in DeKalb. They all congregated down in that south end zone.
Sounds like a reality show, Battle of the Bands.
There you go.
I think it was Vince Lombardi who said the last 2 minutes of the first half and the first 2 minutes of the second half, the two most important parts of a football game, and I think that's playing out right now.
Everson on this drive, Tom, 4 of 5, four different receivers. McCray knocked down.
Wow. That's one heck of an open field tackle by Alva Hansbrough.
5'10 senior cornerback steps up and makes the hit when he had to have it.
Well designed play. It's blocked well. Gray sees it right. Hansbrough just makes a picture perfect tackle. Nobody behind him. Saved the touchdown right there.
Clock down to 35 seconds and running. A 3rd and 8 situation. Everson looking, looking, has time, throws, has his man. Into the end zone, I believe, did the football come loose?
No, he broke the plane. I think they're going to call this a touchdown. The ball did come out.
And they will call it an Ohio touchdown. Rudy Sylvan, number 88, finds pay dirt. Real good throw here by Everson.
Real good drive. Uchik with the hit, balls across the plate. They may review this, but that's a touchdown.
Drive took 4:34 to complete. Snap for the extra point, Lasher's kick, perfect. And it's 17-14. Ohio gets what they need, a long, sustained drive for a touchdown. That's, as you look at Silver.
That's a strike right there. Great throw, and again, the ball's across the plane. It does come loose. But that's exactly what the Bobcats needed going into halftime. Just a well-designed play. Good pitch, good catch.
Now where does it come out is the question.
Ball's over the line right there.
That's a touchdown.
Yes. Well, it's going to stay a touchdown because they kicked the extra point.
Correct. Fifth different receiver on the drive. That's impressive.
Well, that's a senior quarterback as well. Austin Everson. High percentage passes. Mixing the run with McCray.
The Northern does have all three of their timeouts remaining. With just 20 and a half seconds to work with.
Marcus Perez.
And he doesn't have, Phil Horvath does not have the group of receivers he's had in recent years.
The PJ Flex, the Dan Sheldons, Sam Hurd.
That's correct. It's a good group led by Britt Davis, but it's an inexperienced group. In fact, I think you factor out Britt Davis, the rest of their receivers combined for just 20 catches last season. So they're still feeling their way in this offense.
Perez is going to bring it out, and Perez has a little room to run, and he'll be knocked down at the 22 or 23, a 24-yard return with 10 seconds left.
And I think the new NCAA rule where the clock begins as soon as the kicker's foot hits the ball is really going to limit what they're able to do here with just a few seconds left. And now as the clock is set, they are going to go into halftime and not even get a playoff.
That will be it. So the Huskies head to the locker room with a three-point lead. 17-14 on a late Ohio touchdown. Everson to Rudy Sylvan. 17-14.
I think the Bobcats have to be very happy with their offensive production. As I said, last week against Tennessee Martin, a Division I AA opponent, just 144 total yards for the game. So they made vast improvement in a short period of time.
Second quarter yards, Ohio 94-48. And let's go to Jim Blaney with Coach Joe Novak.
All right, David, thank you very much. Coach, I know you want to get out of here quick because I'm guessing this is a chess match between staffs because it's all about adjustments. The first and second halves were a lot different than the other.
No question. Frank's got them ready to play. They got a great scheme, and we're struggling right now. We got to get some pressure on the quarterback.
All right, Coach Novak's going to get to the chalkboard. David, back to you.
All right, Jim, that's right. Pressure on the quarterback. We'll talk about that. We'll have stats, highlights, and a whole bunch more coming up at halftime. It's Northern Illinois 17, Ohio University 14. It's great college football and a beautiful Saturday in DeKalb on Comcast SportsNet.
NIU, serving the heart of America's heartland. Educating new leaders for the nation's third largest region. Bringing expertise and innovation to communities and public schools. Creating new jobs and new workers. Conducting research that improves our quality of life. Northern Illinois University. Across the region, from Chicago to the Mississippi, NIU works.
Stop on in, you got what you need. Stop on in, you're on the run.
At Casey's, we don't do thin and skimpy pizzas. Casey's piles them up real heavy. All month, get free cheese breadsticks with the purchase of any large pizza. Come in now and enter to win the Snickers Casey's Super Bowl Celebration Sweepstakes. You and a friend could end up at Super Bowl 41 in Miami.
Stop on in to Casey's General Store.
Ah!
Bears fans, when the game is over, turn to U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live for in-depth post-game coverage. Our all-pro crew breaks down all the excitement, complete with their grades and expert analysis. Plus, we're live outside the locker room with instant player reactions, inside the press room for all the post-game news conferences, and we'll have a preview of the next big matchup for the Monsters of the Midway. U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live after every Bears game, only on Comcast Sportsnet. On the next Ami Manera, for Latin American baseball players, adjusting to American culture can be hard.
Es difícil cuando llegas a este país y te sientas y no sabes qué carrizo está diciendo el de al lado mío.
But the success of Ozzie Guillen and others continues to provide inspiration.
Y eso le sirve para los jovencitos que están empezando ahora a jugar este béisbol, que la vida todo es posible.
Ami Manera, presented by your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Chevy dealers and United Auto Insurance Group. Sunday only on Comcast Sportsnet.
Welcome to the U.S. Cellular Halftime Report from Husky Stadium, where Northern Illinois is leading Ohio 17-14. Jim Blaney, and I'm joined by Steve Simmons, the men's soccer coach here at Northern Illinois University. And, Coach, I'll let you start out by bragging about your team a little bit. Won yesterday against Drake, and then you went in and you played some Big Ten competition against Michigan State in their tournament and beat them up there.
Well, you know, Michigan State had just come off of an upset win over number 3 New Mexico, and so for us to beat a Big Ten team who just beat number 3 at third place was big. And we had a great game against Michigan the day before that. We should have won that. So, you know, we're a little disappointed we didn't beat both Michigan and Michigan State.
Obviously, when we come here for football, we talk about what Joe Novak has done in building the football program. But we're seeing it all throughout the athletic department in Northern Illinois, Rob Judson in the basketball department. Now, I know on your roster, you have a lot of kids from the western suburbs. And with the soccer mad, as the western suburbs are in Chicago, can you continue to build your program by continually mining that area of Chicago?
Well, you know, we're 30-40 minutes away from these fantastic pools of talent, and so far we've done really well to get probably about 75-80% of our roster from the western suburbs, and that's all the way from Barrington down to Frankfort and Joliet. So, you know, that's the bread and the butter right there, and we want to make sure that we continue to get those kids, because they've gotten an attachment to having their parents come to the game. They've got kids that in the past have had a successful experience at NIU, so we're going to keep going there.
As a college coach, as kids, as you go and recruit kids and watch the high school games and things like that, if you were to go out and talk to all the youth soccer organizations and say, okay, this is what you really need to be teaching the kids, what would that be?
Well, you know what? Obviously, they've got to have a passion for the game. They have to enjoy themselves. Because if they don't enjoy themselves, they won't practice. So that enjoyment is first. And then if they can enjoy themselves and they can really train at their skill level, no matter what sport, they're going to find some success.
There's been a lot of changes, I mentioned, in the Northern Illinois athletic program. And a lot of that's been on the field. But now Jim Phillips, the athletic director, since he's come in, he's really started working the facilities, and especially the one that's being built behind you, the Athletic and Academic Performance Center. Tell me what that will mean to your program.
I tell you what, it's going to be tremendous for us. It's the study table size is going to be just massive. Strength conditioning, which all of our sports use, it's just going to be awesome, and all of our student athletes, coaching staffs are going to benefit tremendously, and we're all excited to get in that building next August.
As you build your schedule and build the program, I know one of the things that you're doing is you're making sure you get top 25 teams on the schedule, because let's face it, that's the way you become a top 25 team yourself. Going forward for your program, will your scheduling philosophy change, or do you just plan and keep loading up on the big boys?
Well, you know what? You look at what Joe Novak's done, you know, the Marylands and Alabamas and so on, and to get the kind of recruits that we need to get, we have to play that schedule, and we won't know how good we are until we play that level of team, and we're out there to try to win a national championship, and in order to do that, we got to play with those big boys, and so we're excited to play. You know, we're at Washington next week, Notre Dame next year at Indiana, Duke, and we want to take all comers. So that means we got a lot of work to do, and we're excited to compete in that schedule.
Did you bring a future Husky along with you today?
Absolutely. It's Keegan Simmons, who's a soccer crazy guy, but he's a Husky crazy guy, and he loves NIU totally.
Steve, thank you for your time. Continued success with the program. Steve Simmons, the men's soccer coach here at Northern Illinois. We are at halftime with Northern Illinois leading Ohio 17-10. Dave and Tom are back with highlights from the opening half when we continue on the U.S. Cellular Halftime Report.
You know, there are some things families just don't like to share.
They don't want to share this.
Or this.
Or these.
Or this. That's why with U.S. Cellular's family plan, everyone in the family gets their own phone. Plus, they can talk to each other free. Speaking of which, does anyone want to talk about these? Oh, those are Dwayne's! See, you thought you lost them.
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Right now, get up to four free phones when you buy one for only $29.95.
At Jewel, it's the fresh way we trim. Slice. Serve. The fresh way we grind. Prepare. Fish. It's offering the freshest variety. The best poultry, beef, pork, seafood that's so fresh. And help from our experts in store. Top quality, great service. All fresh to your family from Jewel.
Advance your career with an MBA from Northern Illinois University.
I was able to balance my MBA with my professional life as well as my personal life. And best of all, NIU's MBA program is AACSB accredited and affordable.
I was impressed with the knowledge and experience of the professors, and the program provided me with a well-rounded business education. The affordability and convenient locations made my decision easy, and it made my MBA a reality.
Designed for the working professional, the MBA program at Northern Illinois University. Start your career today.
NIU, serving the heart of America's heartland. Educating new leaders for the nation's third largest region. Bringing expertise and innovation to communities and public schools. Creating new jobs and new workers. Conducting research that improves our quality of life. Northern Illinois University. Across the region, from Chicago to the Mississippi, NIU works.
Hey, you guys are just like Supercuts, right?
You bet. Have a seat.
Next.
Style only works.
Wow. I'm the best.
If it works for you. Supercuts, every time.
Welcome back to DeKalb. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle, Jim Blaney with you here on a beautiful Saturday for college football. The first home game of the season for the Huskies, and they have a 17-14 lead at the half. It's time for the Fatties Mid-American Conference scoreboard. Fatties Pub and Grill here in town, and you look, Akron with a big upset. They beat NC State on the road today, 20-17. Michigan all over Central Michigan up in Ann Arbor at the Big House, 41-17. And Louisville put it on cruise control early, and they win in rout fashion, 62-0.
Louisville's going to put a big number on a lot of teams this
year. They're great. Army, 17-14, overtime winners over Kent State. Purdue in overtime beat Miami of Ohio, 38-31. And Buffalo Bowling Green in the first are locked up at 7. Michigan State 7-3 over Eastern Michigan in the first. Later starts Indiana at Ball State, and Toledo is at Western Michigan. Tommy, your thoughts when you look at the first half. Northern Illinois had a great first quarter. Ohio, an equally good second quarter.
Yeah, I think they got to get the ball. The Huskies have to get the ball in the hands of Garrett Wolf a little bit more. 13 carries in the first half. We talked about it as one of the keys. He needs to carry the football 30 times. 30 times usually equates to 150 yards on the ground for Garrett Wolf. More Garrett Wolf. He's a Heisman candidate. I think they need to put the ball in his hands a little more often.
All right, let's take a look at some highlights from the first half. As you go through a look at some of the touchdowns, there were some pretty touchdowns as well. Here's Garrett Wolf on the first score. Turns the corner, and once he gets to that point, it's over.
Now they did a nice job again controlling the perimeter of the Bobcat defense, and Garrett Wolf found his way in the end zone a couple of times. This is just unfortunately a bad play by safety Dustin Utschick, who comes in on a bad angle. Great decision throwing the football to William Norwood, who comes in for the big play touchdown. And then two plays later, Garrett Wolf explodes for a huge TD of his own. Again, you have to keep the football in his hands. You control the clock, and he is your best option to score. But then a great drive from the Ohio Bobcats to end the first half. Austin Everson to Rudy Sylvan, and they really go into halftime with a ton of momentum. They ate up a bunch of the clock, and they had a very solid first half of football. You look at the numbers, and again, 7.4 yards per carry for the Huskies. I think they have to keep it on the ground. And again, if you're Frank Solich and you're the Bobcats, try to keep their top-ranked weapon, Garrett Wolf, on the sidelines by controlling the clock yourself and running the football. I expect a lot in the second half, though. I think it's going to be a very exciting final 30 minutes of football.
Northern Illinois just 1 of 5 on third down. Ohio is 3 of 7. But time of possession, very telling stat. Northern 11:41 and Ohio 18:19.
And we talked about it in the open. Frank Solich wanted to control the clock, control the pace, rely on his running game and his defense. And so far, his football team's in this one.
Are you surprised it's this close?
I am a little bit, especially after talking to Joe Novak before the game. He said the Huskies had a tremendous week of practice. They have the most explosive player maybe in college football on their team. And Garrett Wolf had a solid first half. Just think that the Husky defense is probably a little disappointed, especially after the poor offensive performance of the Bobcats in week one. I think the Huskies felt they could contain this offense, and they really have not done that so far to this point.
How about Garrett Wolf? Your impressions of what you're seeing here, first home game of his senior season.
I'm constantly amazed. He can get to the edge. They do a nice job with the stretch play, let him use his vision, his quickness, and then his overall speed. He is so strong at 177 pounds. He can carry the ball between tackles. You'll see him blast through the line of scrimmage. And again, a quick shake, lose a defender, and then he hits that final gear that gets him into the end zone. He does it all. We have not seen him involved in the passing game yet, and as we talked earlier as well, that's something they wanted to do this year coming into the 2006 season. Get him the ball in the passing game, get him out in space, and let him do his thing through the air as well.
So as you're saying, game plan in the second half?
Oh, more Garrett Wolf. You don't have to throw it to him. Just keep handing it to him. Garrett Wolf right, Garrett Wolf left, Garrett Wolf up the middle. I think the Huskies will do just fine. And for Ohio, keep doing what you're doing. High percentage passes, run the football, and rely on your veteran defense.
All right, we'll take a timeout. We'll come back, have the second half kick. Should have a great second half. 17-14, NIU over Ohio on Comcast Sports.
NIU fans, when you enter the Village Commons bookstore, you're entering Husky territory. VCB is the official site for NIU athletics, featuring the new NIU logo on a wide range of hats, t-shirts, shorts, sweats, and NIU logo gifts and accessories. Whether you're a student, graduate, or a fan of NIU athletics, the Village Commons bookstore is your Husky headquarters. Visit us in DeKalb or call us toll-free 800-700-4868 or on the web at www.vcbs.com.
Looking for a wireless phone and service? The Phone Store features service from Sprint PCS, U.S. Cellular, T-Mobile, and Nextel. Why buy a phone from a store that offers only one carrier? At The Phone Store, our friendly, knowledgeable staff will help you compare between all of our carriers and help you find the phone and service that fits your needs the best. The Phone Store, with two great locations, in Rochelle next to Sullivan's Foods and in DeKalb on Sycamore Road next to Great Clips by Aldi, or call 815-78-PHONE.
Husky fans, Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb is your official pre- and post-game NIU football headquarters. Whether you're catching a game on our big screens or having some of our famous grilled food out in our beer garden, Fatty's is the place to be. Join us on September 9th for our season kickoff outdoor tent party. And don't forget the Fatty's Ultimate Tailgate at the University of Iowa. For more information, log on to fattyspub.com. It's all at Fatty's Pub and Grill, located directly south of Husky Stadium on Route 38 in DeKalb.
On the next American Era, for Latin American baseball players, adjusting to American culture can be hard.
Es difícil cuando llega a este país y te sientas y no sabes qué carrizo está diciendo el de al lado mío.
But the success of Ozzie Guillen and others continues to provide inspiration.
Y eso le sirve para los jovencitos que están empezando ahora a jugar este béisbol, que en la vida todo es posible.
American Era, presented by your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Chevy dealers and United Auto Insurance Group. Sunday only on Comcast Sportsnet. After the Bears game, turn to Comcast Sportsnet for U.S. Cellular Bears Postgame Live. Our expert team breaks down all the action and brings you live player interviews and press conferences. U.S. Cellular Bears Postgame Live after every Bears game on Comcast Sportsnet.
Tomorrow, the Champs playing on Comcast Sportsnet. The series wraps up on the South Side as Jim Thome and the White Sox slug it out with the Indians in high definition. Coverage starts with Velcro White Sox pregame live. White Sox Indians tomorrow at 12:30 on Comcast Sportsnet.
And welcome back to Husky Stadium. Jim Brilliant along with Frank Solich. And Frank, am I watching a football game or am I watching a chess match between two coaching staffs?
No, it's a good football game. You know, they're so explosive on offense that you can never take a deep breath because they have a chance to put it in the end zone. Of course, with Garrett on the ground, and they got an excellent throwing game. So we're going to have to take care of the ball. We had the one turnover. Neither team's had a sack. They've had four real explosive plays. We've only had a couple. We got to pick that up. But I am feeling good about the fact that we were able to establish a couple drives against them, which is critical.
And you have to feel good about that drive to end of the first half.
Yeah, that was what we needed to certainly get us back in this ball game, and then also keep their offense off the field. That'll accomplish a couple things.
Coach, thank you for your time. Good luck in the second half. Dave and Tom, back to you.
You know, it's very interesting. Coach Novak talked about this when he left the field at halftime, and now Coach Solich is talking about it coming onto the field in the second half, a lack of a Husky pass rush. Last year, Northern Illinois with just 19 sacks. And I know that Coach Novak talked about getting to the opposing quarterback more often to take some pressure off of a group of corners that are solid, that are good, but at times are mismatched in terms of speed. They have not sacked a quarterback today. They have not put pressure on Austin Everson. He has made some quality decisions. And right now, I think that they have allowed this Bobcat football team to stay in this game because they have not come up with those big plays.
Well, I would think that if you're going to get to the quarterback, one of those key guys will be Ken West.
I would think so. He's, you know, not an overly large defensive end at 6'1 and 243, but he's very quick. He's very disruptive. Problem is, you got a senior quarterback for Ohio in Austin Everson, who's made all the right decisions. The only turnover they had was just a great strip by Ken West. It was a solid play. They gained 9 yards on it. Unfortunately for the Bobcats, you know, they turned it over. But I think Frank Solich has to be very happy with the way his team's played so far. As he mentioned, they've done a nice job establishing a few drives. They've kept the Husky offense off the field for more than half of the first half. And I think if they stick to their game plan, they feel very confident about getting out of here. May not be a pretty victory, but I think the Bobcats would take any victory back to Athens, Ohio.
Later today, Derek Lee and the Cubs continue their series in Atlanta when they slug it out with Andrew Jones and the Braves. Coverage starts with Cubs pregame live presented by Verizon Wireless. Cubs Braves today at 5:30 right here on Comcast Sports Net.
They're just a game and a half out of the wild card race, aren't they, the Cubs?
Game and a half out of 15.
I'm sorry.
Just hasn't gone well. It'll turn around. It'll win the division.
Anybody can have a horrible century, right?
My line. They're going to win the division next year. No comment on that one?
No, we're all working for the same bosses right now. I think I've said too much already.
All right, here we go. Second half action. Marcus Perez and Britt Davis deep for Northern Illinois. Ohio will put it in play. Matt Lasher kicks it high. It'll come down right around 2 yards deep in the end zone. And Perez says, I'm coming out. And Perez turns the corner. There's a flag. A second flag comes flying. We'll find out just what it is. Looked like an illegal block.
And there's a flag at about the 10-yard line, which means we're going to start with some pretty poor field position.
A hold on Northern Illinois.
And just in case that wasn't good enough, a block in the back as well.
A second penalty. So they will mark this off, and Northern Illinois going to start at their own 5-yard line.
Wow, I wonder if that's a push in the back. You know, you're taught to be aggressive, but at the same time, it has to be controlled aggression.
Smart aggression.
That's right. And once a guy passes your face,
don't touch him.
Don't touch him.
Horvath at the controls. Hands it to Garrett Wolf. And Garrett Wolf has a big
ball running through a tackle there. Tony Ward at the worst end of this confrontation. It's again the stretch play and a huge hole created by that. Right there, there's Tony Ward. Oops. You know what, Tony, don't be embarrassed. Garrett Wolf has done that to a number of defenders over the last 2.5 years.
Todd Koenig with the tackle.
Look at that.
But a tremendous run, gets right out of trouble. 33 yards, he had only 16 in the second quarter. 33 on that one. And they're at the 38. And Britt Davis will throw it away.
You do not know how good a play that was, by Britt Davis.
Great play.
That was set up as a bubble screen that was going to be a pass to, I believe it was Jarrett Carter that was running down the sideline, a double pass. Britt Davis, a quarterback last season before jumping to the wide receiver position. And at this point, he's just trying to make sure he doesn't come up with a negative play. And as long as he throws that ball past the line of scrimmage, that's not intentional grounding. What a heads-up play by Britt Davis.
Second and 10 after a bit of trickery by the Huskies. They'll hand it to Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf! Boy, every time he makes that first wave of tacklers miss, you think there's a chance something special is going to happen. Koenig again in on the tackle.
I don't know that you need the trick plays in the playbook when that young man is dotting your eye.
Five on that one. It's a third and five situation.
And again, just to stress what Britt Davis did, instead of taking a 5 or 10 yard loss and having third and 10 or third and 15, the fact that he got rid of that football makes this a manageable third down.
Horvath throws, and it's got his man. It's Britt Davis. And that's a first down. 11 yards on that game.
Two excellent plays in this drive. Britt Davis, just a simple out route. Little pivot route, turn to the inside, work to the outside. Phil Horvath with a nice throw. But again, that drive is kept alive by Britt Davis's decision a couple plays earlier to throw that ball away.
Going down the field and nearly hits Britt Davis again. Just overthrown.
I think Phil Horvath would like to have this one back. Just puts a little too much air underneath it. Just outside the reach of Britt Davis. A well-designed play. If he catches it, he's taking it in for six.
Second and 10 at the Ohio 46.
And I usually can't tell whether or not Joe Novak is upset or not, because he normally gets that hands on the knees position, and I don't know if he's disturbed or is he just catching a breather.
Garrett Wolf takes the handoff, drives his legs. A gain of 4 on the play.
This is a huge play in this ball game. Same play again. You see the entire left side of that offensive line. Poole come to the right, try to create a crease.
Drive started at their own 5.
Well, and after Ohio took it in for the touchdown to create some momentum for them, the Huskies come out with the opening kickoff of the second half. Very important for them to answer with a few points of their own.
Third and 6. Horvath under pressure throws, and Britt Davis cannot come up with it. Horvath was belted down.
Full safety blitz there. Tony Ward comes in. Tyler Rush from the weak side linebacker position. 1, 2, 3. They're rushing 8. 8 Bobcats coming in on the rush.
Got a wide open receiver.
You had Britt Davis sitting
Jake
down.
Jake Nordine right down the middle of the field.
You had Britt Davis sitting just beyond the third or the first down marker. Jake Nordine with no one on him.
Koenig banged up a bit as he heads to the sideline. Get better, another punt, and this one's gonna roll and gonna stop at the 14-yard line. So a 28-yard punt, but good
field position for the Husky defense inside the 20. We'll be right back at Comcast SportsNet.
My wife works hard. The kids are 10, 6, and 3. Our life together gets a little crazy. So I called Applebee's like I'd done before. They brought our favorite foods out to my car door.
With Applebee's Carside To Go, you call it in, we bring it out.
Now my wife runs to meet me just as fast as she can, cause there's something women like about a pickup man.
Applebee's Carside To Go. It's not fast food, it's Applebee's food fast.
Are you ready for new windows and siding? Just call Empire today. Our triple pane windows feature self-cleaning glass and a lifetime limited glass breakage warranty. Our vinyl siding is energy efficient and maintenance free. You can trust Empire today for professional installation in just 2 weeks. You'll save with warehouse direct prices, plus make no payments till 2008. So if you are thinking about new windows or siding, we're ready when you are. Call Empire today.
800-588-2300-EMPIRE.
Today.
And we are back in DeKalb. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle, and Jim Blaney with you. First and 10 for Ohio at their own 15 is where they spot it. There's pressure, and it's thrown out of bounds. That's the first time we've seen Emerson really under great duress.
You're right. We talked about
Tim McCarthy
coming out of the half. The Huskies need to create some quarterback pressure and get Emerson out of his rhythm. Good job right there. Just a blitz. McCarthy comes in, gets in Everson's face. Fortunately for the Bobcats, he throws it out of bounds. Good coverage on the play as well.
15. Second and 10 at their own 15 with 12:18 to go, third quarter. Good Mid-American Conference tilt here. Pressure's coming. And a real good throw. Emerson took a seat again, but he was able to deliver it for a gain of 5. Real solid play again, Tom.
Yeah, but if you cannot put more pressure on the quarterback with 7 and 8 man rushes, he's going to do this to you because he's a veteran QB. He's going to take the hit. Ryder coming in from his safety position. But again, if you're going to bring 7 or 8 defenders after the quarterback, you have to get him to the turf or you're exposing your secondary to big plays.
Here's a 3rd and 5, a key situation for Ohio. He handles the snap and he finds his big tight end again.
They've made a living.
Rudy Sylvan made the catch. Sits down in the middle of the field and gets a first down.
They've found some soft spots in that Husky defense, just finding zones. You see Ryder losing his footing. But Sylvan does a great job finding his seam in between the linebackers and just throwing again a high possession, high percentage pass and moving the chains. This is exactly what Coach Solich wanted.
Gain of 9. It's a 1st and 10 at the 29. A handoff around the corner, and Tim McCarthy, I believe, came over with Dustin Utchick. Was that Utchick who made the tackle? Chris Garrett was the man that carried the football.
Ohio now also showing some different looks on offense. This is a 2 tight end set, the reverse. Great job by Utchick sniffing it out.
That was all Utchick.
Does a nice job limiting the play, just 5 yards.
Gain of 5 and a 2nd and 5 at the 34. McCray picks his way near a 1st down.
Well, they're attacking that northern defense with a lot of misdirection.
They'll call that a 4-yard gain, maybe 4.5. It's going to be close, but just short of a 1st down. So it's a 3rd and 1.
Good job by McCray, finding a little seam, getting some positive yardage. But I'm telling you right now, I mentioned it in the 1st half, Austin Emerson is going to make that fake one of these days and find some daylight going the other direction.
Get enough push and they will have a 1st down. Gain of 3. He needed 1. He got it.
That's a 220-pound quarterback.
There you see the push.
Nice job again by Tim McCarthy. Tim McCarthy does a nice job filling the hole, but Everson's done a nice job today. Haven't seen much of Brad Bauer because Everson's played so well.
This time it's going to be the quarterback Everson who keeps it this time, as you said, off the fake.
I think
left side, a big game.
My headset, Frank Solich, has just got crossed there, I believe. I think they finally heard what I was saying.
13 yards on that play.
This particular play has been there all afternoon. If you keep hitting them with that misdirection with McCray, sooner or later, you got to keep them honest. And Austin Everson does just that.
What a gorgeous animal that is. The Husky dog.
Everson's got this Husky defense panting as well right now.
Garrett, the man in motion. They're going to give it to Garrett, and Garrett will pick up. They'll call it two.
Ball carried by Chris Garrett.
With every positive play, though, this Bobcat offense is getting more and more confident.
McCarthy and Crutch combined on the stop. 9th play of the drive that started at the 15-yard line.
You just saw Brad Bauer, the other quarterback the Bobcats use. He might as well put his helmet away. Everson's playing good football this afternoon.
Here comes pressure, and he has belted down.
I take that back. Maybe Bauer ought to go get his helmet if they keep hitting Everson like that.
Corey Hansen was free and clear on a blitz, and he belted Austin Everson.
So you see again, here come 7 Huskies. Unblocked to the quarterback, Corey Hansen. But once again, they do not get to Everson in time to register the sack. He gets rid of the ball.
3rd and 8 now. 8:47 to go in the third. Everson looking. Looking, has time, throws, it's got his man. Money pass right on the numbers. Scott Mayo, their leading receiver, makes the catch. It's a first down and a gain of 27 yards.
The Huskies are just not getting any pressure on the quarterback with their standard 4-man rush. And Everson continues to find the open receiver. Wasn't the most aesthetically pleasing throw I've ever seen, but certainly very effective.
McCray picking his way inside the 5-yard line.
And now the Husky defense has got to honor the fact that Everson may keep this ball. So not only do they have to defend McCray, but they also have to be aware that Everson may keep it himself.
Gain of 15 yards and a first and goal at the Northern Illinois 4-yard line.
And the Northern defense is tired right now.
Well, wholesale changes on that D-line. Toss to McCray. McCray trying to turn the corner, picking his way, and he's in. Get it 6. Touchdown, Ohio Bobcats, and they've got the lead.
That's how you put together a drive, young high school football coaches. You mix the run and the pass, and right here, McCray seems to be getting stronger with each carry. Does a great job feeling a seam. Mark Ryder steps up and misses the tackle. McCray does a fabulous job finding the end zone.
A 12-play, 85-yard drive. That was methodical. Extra point by last year's perfect. We are breaking. Possession change coming up. Bobcats 21, Huskies 17. Indicator.
Ask a few of your friends what they thought after having LASIK eye surgery at the Hauser Ross Eye Institute.
Yeah.
And you might hear something like this.
Yeah, it's one of those things that until afterward, I don't know how I got along without it. You know, my biggest question for my doctor at Hauser Ross was, why did I wait so long to do this?
Find out why so many people have trusted the Hauser Ross Eye Institute for LASIK eye surgery. Call 1-800-CHECKUP today.
Bears fans, when the game is over, turn to U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live for in-depth post-game coverage. Our all-pro crew breaks down all the excitement, complete with player grades and expert analysis. Plus, we're live outside the locker room with instant player reactions, inside the press room for all the post-game news conferences, and we'll have a preview of the next big matchup for the Monsters of the Midway. U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live after every Bears game, only on Comcast Sportsnet. Today, Cubs baseball plays on Comcast Sportsnet. Derek Lee leads the way for the Northsiders as they battle Andrew Jones and the Braves in Atlanta. Coverage starts with Cubs pregame live presented by Verizon Wireless. Cubs Braves, today at 5:30 on Comcast Sportsnet. Every Wednesday and Thursday, tune into Bears Blitz on Comcast Sportsnet. Gear up for the next big matchup with press conferences, one-on-one interviews, news of the day, and more. Bears Blitz every Wednesday and Thursday at 4:30 only on Comcast Sportsnet.
Welcome back to Husky Stadium with Ohio now leading Northern Illinois 21-17. And remember how this game started off for the Ohio offense. Their first two plays of the game, they didn't even get the playoff. They had false start penalties. Now the guys are over here on the bench. They're saying to each other, look at the scoreboard. We have battled our way back. We need to keep battling. David, back to you.
All right. Thank you, Jim. They're playing very good football. Last two Ohio drives. Check this out, Tom. 22 plays, 154 yards, and two touchdowns.
That was surgical, that last drive. You called it methodical, I called it surgical.
Brent Davis on this kick return, and he's come up short of the 20. It'll be about the 17-yard line. I'd like to thank our great crew up here. Todd Armour, our longtime spotter, and the best stat man in the business, Ethan Cooperson. He's off to New England for the Buffalo-New England game tomorrow.
He's got better things to do than hang with us.
That's
so he's
exactly
leaving.
Right. Bobcat scoring drive, 12 plays, 85 yards. They needed 439 to find pay dirt, a four-yard TD run for Calvin McCray.
Well, we revisit the keys to the game. We talked about it at the start of this ball game. Garrett Wolf needs more carries. They had to shut down that Ohio offense to keep them from running the football. They haven't been able to do that, and turnovers really haven't been a factor so far today.
Carter makes the catch, and he is smacked down after a gain of three.
No reason to panic either if you're
right,
Joe Novak
the tackle.
And the Huskies. They've got the most explosive running back in college football. They've got more than 22 minutes left in this ball game, and you're going to get the wind in the fourth quarter, so go back to their game plan, which is a lot of number one.
Horvath looking, throws, has Brent Davis. That's a first down out to the 33. Gain of 13. Huskies moving.
Garrett Wolf showing you he can be a blocker as well. He's out in front protecting Phil Horvath. You see Brent Davis just coming in, sitting down, finding a hole in that defense. Look at that. Garrett Wolf actually getting a hand, creating a little space for his quarterback, protecting his quarterback. I'll tell you what, Britt Davis has really taken to the wide receiver position well in a short period of time.
Horvath looking down the sideline, and it dropped by Garrett Wolf. Would have been a tough catch.
Well designed play, just a wheel route.
Covered the play by Tyler Russ, number 26 for Ohio.
You see Wolf run to the flat and then turn it up. And Phil Horvath just throws it behind him. A play I'm sure Garrett thinks he should have made. But if Horvath hits him in stride, that may turn into six.
Horvath looking, throws, got Britt Davis into Northern Illinois, first down.
I was just mentioning, I'm really impressed with Britt Davis, who came to Northern as a quarterback and actually took some snaps as a quarterback last year. He's just got a great feel for the wide receiver position. Helped by being an ex-quarterback, does a nice job keeping his feet in bounds and also catching the football with his hands. Very explosive player.
At the 46, they give it to Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf turns the corner
7-yard line. Gain of 17 more.
Britt Davis participates with a catch the play before. Now he's going to help Garrett Wolf as a lead blocker out there. I love that from Garrett Wolf. He's not going to sit back and allow defensive players to tee off on him. Yeah, he goes out of bounds, but at the same time,
he delivers a blow.
He delivers a little bit of a blow.
Late, great Walter Payton.
To TJ Wright.
Hand off to Garrett Wolf. Drives to the 35-yard line. Gain of a yard, maybe a yard and a half.
We talked about being the bug on some plays and the windshield on others. Matt Muncy was the windshield on that play. Garrett Wolf, the bug. 166 total rushing yards from Garrett Wolf to this point. I thought 150 would be good for a Husky victory.
Garrett Wolf, and this one goes nowhere. He's going to lose yardage.
I think Garrett's
Marcus
a little.
Marcus Parham hit him.
I think Garrett Wolf's a little tired right now. They had him in the passing game running down the sideline. They've given him the football. Really just nowhere to go. Nice play.
Yeah, he's going to come out
from
right
the
now.
Edge. Yeah, but Garrett looks a little gassed right now.
Montel Clinton, who's a sophomore back out of Rockford, Illinois, will come in and replace Garrett Wolf here. But an obvious passing down.
I think Superman even slept at times as well, didn't he?
A bit. Not often, but just a little bit. Snap to Horvath. Looking, there's a hold coming up on Doug Free. Horvath's going to run for about 8, but it's all for naught. They're going to get Doug Free, I believe, on a hold. The All-American was nailed there. You could see it all the way. Watched it right at the top of your screen there, coming up on the right side, and there's the hold right there, and the flag flies.
They really didn't need to do it because Phil Horvath was feeling the pressure and
had already rolled.
Rolling out it at that time anyway.
Holding. 70 of the offense. 10 yards from the previous
call. Calling it on 70, but that is not, I believe, where the penalty came.
I'm with you. I think Doug Free was the culprit there. As I said earlier, I don't care who your offensive coordinator is. I don't know that.
Third and a mile now. Third and 20.
You have a whole lot of third and 20-yard plays that you complete or convert with any degree of regularity.
Horvath looking, going down the field, and it's broken up. Britt Davis nearly caught it. Crowd wanted a flag for pass interference, not going to get it. The Huskies are punted away.
Now the penalty kills him on this drive. Horvath has time. Ball floats on him a little bit. I'm not sure that Britt Davis was going to be in bounds if he caught that ball anyway. Again, third and 20. I'm going to convert that very often.
Chris Garrett is the deep man. Andy Dittbetter, the punter, the sophomore. Gets it away. A driving kick. Garrett takes it. Going to bring it. And he'll be knocked down at the 25-yard line after a 34-yard punt and 12-yard return. We are breaking. Don't go away, folks. We got a real good football game going on in DeKalb, Illinois. Ohio, 21. Northern Illinois.
Looking for a wireless phone and service? The Phone Store features service from Sprint PCS, U.S. Cellular, T-Mobile, and Nextel. Why buy a phone from a store that offers only one carrier? At The Phone Store, our friendly, knowledgeable staff will help you compare between all of our carriers and help you find the phone and service that fits your needs the best. The Phone Store with two great locations, in Rochelle next to Sullivan's Foods and in DeKalb on Sycamore Road next to Great Clips by Aldi, or call 815-78-PHONE.
The verdict is in. The College of Law at Northern Illinois University is one of the nation's most respected law schools. At NIU Law, top students are part of a tight-knit, dynamic, and diverse learning community. Small classes give them unmatched access to some of the best legal scholars in the country, and state-of-the-art technology prepares them for today's courtrooms. Many NIU Law students even get hands-on legal practice before they graduate. That's why so many successful lawyers and judges hold degrees from the NIU College of Law. NIU Law. Discover the difference.
Ohio on the attack at their own 25. Let's take a look at the upcoming schedule for the NIU Huskies. We're going to be here the next 2 weeks, Tommy. And Buffalo in next week for a night game, and then Indiana State here.
Starting with today's game against Ohio, the Huskies need to make some hay. Three consecutive conference games at home.
And McCray breaking tackles. McCray up the sideline. Big gain for Calvin McCray. And you can see the life in the Ohio sideline. 17-yard gain.
And no doubt they're starting to become more and more confident that they can move the ball in this front seven of Northern Illinois. There's a reason why Calvin McCray was an all-MAC performer last season. He's got a tremendous amount of talent. They are certainly having a much better day on offense than they did last week against Tennessee Martin. And that pass nearly picked off, and a flag's gonna fly. Are we gonna have an interference call?
Austin Everson had a mile to run if he would have tucked that ball.
You'll see. If he wants to tuck and go with it, he could have. Ball, nice dive. Looked like the ball was tipped. We're going to catch.
Offensive pass interference.
Yeah, catch the Bobcats for offensive pass interference. Maybe there's a reason why he was so wide open.
You got away with that a few times in your career. A little shove here and there.
Interference on the offense. Blocking downfield while the pass is in the air. It's interference and it's still pursuing.
It's not cheating unless you get caught.
That's right. So it'll be a first and 25.
I don't think Austin Everson is done running the football today, okay? I'm Joe Novak. I'm telling my linebackers, keep an eye on the quarterback. Swing pass and a real good gain. They'll get 10 yards back. Taylor Price made the catch, number 23.
Ohio just caught Northern in a horrible defense. They're coming after him with an 8-man rush. Great job. Everson gets the ball out on the edge. Call it a gain of 14 on the play, and it is a second about 11, maybe 10 yards.
Sometimes good fortune is your greatest ally. Just a great call for that particular defense.
Everson looking, tosses it. McCray breaks one tackle, and McCray's gone. McCray to the house. A big Ohio touchdown, Calvin McCray.
I don't think there's any doubt. The Ohio Bobcats are winning the battle at the line of scrimmage. Their offensive line is getting the best of the front four of the Northern Illinois Huskies. This play has been there all afternoon. You saw McCray fumble it earlier in the first half. A huge seam, and then Tim McCarthy just misses the tackle. You're not going to arm tackle Calvin McCray. Well designed. And then McCray just at 5'11", 210 pounds at good speed, finds his way into the end zone.
Extra point perfect, and all of a sudden the Huskies find themselves 11 points down.
Again, this is an Ohio offense that was only able to rack up 144 yards against Division I AA Tennessee Martin. Today they've gone right through the Husky defense.
Two long TD drives, now a quick strike for a touchdown. Three touchdowns in their last three drives.
And again, a veteran quarterback, a senior quarterback, does a great job selling pass. McCray does a nice job being patient, finds a little bit of a hole, and then Tim McCarthy had a chance to get him down there. You're just not going to arm tackle an all-conference performer like Calvin McCray. Again, though, with 3 minutes to go in the third quarter, I don't think Joe Novak the Huskies can panic, Garrett Wolf can get to the end zone just as quick as Calvin McCray.
But they got to get back to getting the ball to Garrett Wolf.
They do, and they have to protect the football. They got to protect themselves from turnovers, and they have to quit committing penalties. The hold by Doug Free really killed the drive on the last possession for the Huskies.
That one's going to sail to the back of the end zone where Marcus Perez says no thank you, and the Huskies will go on the attack into the wind. First and 10 at their own 20. Last three Ohio drives, 25 plays, 229 yards, and three touchdowns.
It has to be really disappointing for this Husky defense. They are just losing at the line of scrimmage. Denny Dornbus, the defensive coordinator, really has not had an answer from his balanced attack of the Bobcats all afternoon.
Garrett Wolf, single back set as he's been all afternoon long, and they give it to Wolf right here. Garrett Wolf will pick his way for 6 yards. Well on his way to a 200-yard day.
We talked about it earlier. With each snap, that Ohio offense is becoming more and more confident.
Jordan Myers made the tackle.
Huskies need to answer that score with one of their own to get themselves back in this ball game.
Gainer 6, brings up 17-4 for the 26.
Todd Koenig made the hit on Garrett Wolf. We're down to 2:25 in the third.
Well, you just see the
look at Joe Novak there.
Now the Bobcats have a little bit more of a swagger. It's almost as if the Huskies are waiting for something bad to happen at this point. They had such success attacking the perimeter of that Ohio defense with Garrett Wolf. They've really, Ohio shored things up on defense the last several drives.
Horvath, pressured, throws, and it's incomplete. Looking for Britt Davis. And tell you what, there was a little talking going on after the incompletion. And the official's not hesitant to throw flags on that, but nothing, no yellow laundry there.
Well, you see Britt Davis has actually got the inside position on Michael Mitchell.
You see right there, a little bit of talking. That is not what Frank Solich wants to see.
No, he doesn't. This Northern offense is just completely out of sync right now.
Punt comes down, and it will be down at the 42-yard line, a 34-yard punt.
Well, this defense is called an attack 4-3 for Northern, and they really haven't done a whole lot of attacking today. A couple years back, they prided themselves on sacks and turnovers, and really the big plays defensively haven't been there for Northern. But you have to give Ohio a ton of credit. They were an awful group last week offensively, and they have been outstanding so far through almost quarters of football.
On Kerry Owens is the deep man now. Austin Everson throws and finds his man. Finds his man, the big tight end that was out there was Cody Carr, 6'5", makes the catch and rumbles his way for 13 yards.
We've seen this a lot today. Northern is just a step away from the quarterback. They just can't get Everson down on the ground for the big play.
It actually was Rudy Sylvan,
who's had an excellent game today.
I thought I saw 89 in there.
Austin Everson has played a mistake-free football game so far today.
He has been what you expect from a senior.
Absolutely.
And Vonkerry Owens, number 20 with the carry.
They're just playing with tremendous confidence right now, especially
gain
up front
of four
on that offensive line. Regardless of who's carrying it right now, there are some seams. And they're doing a fine job. As we talked about earlier, it's a veteran offensive line, three returning starters. Everyone's at least a junior.
This will be the final play of this quarter.
They'll hand it off again to Owens. And he'll be knocked down after a gain of maybe two. Maybe two.
That's going to be the final play of the third quarter, but a good quarter for the Ohio Bobcats. Ohio 28, Northern Illinois 17, 15 minutes to go. We'll be right back on Comcast SportsNet.
NIU fans, when you enter the Village Commons bookstore, you're entering Husky territory. VCB is the official site for NIU athletics, featuring the new NIU logo on a wide range of hats, t-shirts, shorts, sweats, and NIU logo gifts and accessories. Whether you're a student, graduate, or a fan of NIU athletics, the Village Commons bookstore is your Husky headquarters. Visit us in DeKalb or call us toll-free 800-700-4868 or on the web at www.bcbs.com.
On the next of Nima Era, for Latin American baseball players, adjusting to American culture can be hard.
Es difícil cuando llega a este país y te sientas y no sabes qué carrizo está diciendo el de al lado mío.
But the success of Ozzie Guillen and others continues to provide inspiration.
Y eso le sirve para los jovencitos que están empezando ahora a jugar este béisbol, que en la vida todo es posible.
A Mi Manera, presented by your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Chevy dealers and United Auto Insurance Group. Sunday only on Comcast Sportsnet. This September is a month to remember on Comcast Sportsnet. Huge White Sox games as the champs charge down the stretch. The future is now as the Cubs look to finish strong. U.S. Cellular Bears post-game live return. Ozzie Guillen continues to tell his story on Omni Manera, My Way. Garrett Wolf leads NIU into gridiron action. And Dan Kelly and Ed Olczyk have the call when the Hawks hit the ice for the preseason. It's all this September, only on Comcast Sportsnet.
Welcome back to Brigham Field at Husky Stadium. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle, Jim Blaney. 28-17 Ohio, but Calvin McCray has been everything that we thought he would be and more, Tommy.
Well, there's a reason why he was a 2005 All-Conference player, rushed for over almost 1,200 yards last season. He's done everything today. He's seen the hole, he's gotten through the hole, and he shows you good speed as well. He's a big, strong kid with a lot of quickness, a lot of vision. And he has certainly answered Garrett Wolf's challenge today.
Now the sea of red rises as one, third and four, the start of the fourth quarter. Can the Huskies contain him? It will be an Ohio first down. William Norwood makes the catch. Another good throw from Austin Everson, who has played a whale of a football game.
Yeah, when you're rushing seven defenders and you can't get to the quarterback, you're just asking your cornerbacks to do too much. And right there, Everson had too much time to throw the football.
He gains six. We're going to talk with Northern Illinois' great vice president and athletic director, Jim Phillips, in just a moment as I watch more of your game notes blow out of the booth.
Again, I didn't have anything important written on it.
First and 10. An option pitch. Football's loose and Northern Illinois got it. Paul Pogrus and Kenny West was the man who recovered it.
Dustin Utschick with a huge play, exactly what the Huskies needed, a well-designed play. Everson with a little fake in the option, and Garrett puts it on the ground thanks to a big hit from Utschick. And Kenny West on the spot at the right time. A huge momentum changer and a huge play by a young man who led the MAC in tackles last season, Dustin Utschick.
That is exactly what NIU needed. They got a stop. They took the drive away. And now they're going up top and going for it all. Ball's down there. And Perez has got it. First to 10 for Northern Illinois. A big, big game. 41 yards. Horvath to Perez. Off the second Ohio turnover. Huskies in business.
You think you can feel the momentum changing right now?
Wow.
Just a great throw.
And an even better catch by Marcus Perez.
That is a great play.
Does a great job concentrating on the football. Goes up and catches the tip of the football at its highest point. Just a great individual effort.
Jim Phillips is with us. Jim, you weren't feeling great walking in here at the start of the quarter. You got to feel better right now the way momentum has changed.
You know, we needed a big play that you guys described. That was a big fumble recovery. But all the credit to Ohio for through the first three quarters. I mean, it's been a smash-mouth football game up front, and but that's why you play four, as you guys know. So let's see if we can get a little momentum going.
And you can't panic if you're the Huskies right now because you have such an explosive weapon. And Garrett Wolf, you've got a veteran quarterback out there at Phil Horvath. So certainly 15 minutes is a lot of football.
He's a game changer for sure.
Oh, unbelievable. And they're going to measure on this one. We were talking a little bit ago about your new academic and athletic performance center down in the north end zone. Looks phenomenal. And when do you expect that to be done?
We'll be opening the doors next summer. So we're about 10 months away. 60,000 square feet academic center, state-of-the-art computer labs, tutorial area, study area, classrooms, and then huge strength and conditioning center, sports medicine and rehabilitation center, team locker room, equipment room, and then upstairs is all football. That's coaches' offices and meeting rooms.
But your office will remain
over at the convocation center. Correct.
It's a second and one. Horvath looking, throwing, touchdown, give it six. Marcus Perez, Northern Illinois.
I tell you what, that was a great route by Marcus Perez. Sold the pumps, went to the corner, and just shook Mark Parson. Phil Horvath steps up, gets protection, and you'll see nobody around Marcus Perez. He turned Parson around like a top.
Now they will go for two, which would get them within a field goal. A lot of coaches will disdain the two early in the game, but at this point, the chart, Tommy, says you got to go for the deuce.
Well, you have number one dot in your eye as well. He's averaged 6.6 yards per carry over the course of his career, a veteran quarterback. I think you like your chances, plus you build on the momentum that you've just found.
Better get the play moving. Your play clock is down to 6 seconds. Northern Illinois is going to have to use a timeout here. That cannot make Joe Novak happy.
It's called a party timeout. So involved celebrating the good fortune that you forgot what was going on.
That will be one I'm sure that he will talk with his coaches and his players about. Look at the touchdown again.
Just a tremendous drive. And Marcus Perez, you can't see it at the top of your screen. Trust me, he just ran a great post corner route. Found himself all alone. And this is the type of drive that a defense that has struggled all game long can actually gain some confidence from.
Jim, you gained a big promotion back in July. You're now vice president at the university. Congratulations.
Thanks, Cap and Tom. Appreciate that. But as you guys know, you're only as good as that group that's with you. And we have a tremendous athletic department staff. So any rewards that maybe come my way is certainly a direct reflection of that group that works hard for us every day.
Getting back to the, as you like to call it, the AAPC, the building at the north end, that's going to be a huge help in recruiting. When you go into a home and you tell a parent, look, this is our commitment to academics. It's a great school. But look what we've got. That's tough to beat.
Hey, young kids today, as you know, are great consumers. And they want to know where they're going to learn and train and do the things that they want to do during a college experience, get a degree, and be the best student athlete that they possibly can. So you need to support them with facilities like that.
All right, the Huskies look for the two-point conversion to shave it to a three-point game. They're going to throw. Horvath looks, and it's knocked away. Incomplete. Matt Muncy was the man that got a hand on it.
You see, Phil Horvath just throws it to the wrong shoulder of Jake Nordine. Matt Muncy makes a great play. But if he throws it to Nordine's outside shoulder, you may have a two-point conversion.
Yep, exactly right. So it will remain a five-point game with 13:30 to go, a ton of time. But this is a huge, huge possession for Ohio's offense and NIU's defense. You got a nice crowd here today, Jim.
Good crowd, yeah, good crowd, good turnout. Quite a few groups out here as we always try and strategically garner some of that attention from the western suburbs. But great day for band day. We had about over 2,000 band members from high school all over the area, over the region. That quite a thrill for them to perform at halftime down on Brigham Field.
To speak of recognition, I mean, obviously very difficult Saturday last week. You go into the Horseshoe and play the number one team in the nation, but also some great recognition for your program.
It is, Tom, and I think we've talked before. Athletics is, as we like to term it, is the front porch to the university. Not nearly even close to being the most important, but certainly the most visible. And you can garner some attention for your Department of Accountancy or your engineering school through athletics. And that's what we've been able to do, as you articulated over the last several weeks.
Nendick to put it back in play. Deep kick through the back of the end zone. No return. Ohio goes on the attack. First to 10 at their own 20-yard line. Huge, huge stand for the Northern Illinois defense right now. They've got to come out, stiffen their spine, and try and get a three and out.
Let's go down to the field to Jim Blaney.
All right, David, it's amazing the difference in the messages from the defensive coaching staff to the players the last two times they've come off the field. Two possessions ago, and they came off after the Ohio touchdown. To put it mildly, it was a kick in behind, wrap up, and play to win, not to lose. And then when they came off after the turnover, back to X's and O's. Back to you, David.
All right, Jimmy. Austin Everson rolling under some pressure. He's going to throw this one away. That's the second time today that I remember real solid, solid pressure on him.
Yeah, Brandon Bice gets to Everson, and again, as a veteran, a senior, Everson just throws it away and doesn't take the negative play.
That has got to be something that this week, Jim, your coaching staff is going to work on getting to the quarterback.
Thank you, right, Cap.
Good things happen when you take the opposing quarterback to the ground.
Second and 10 at the 20. Squirt away and is not going to get very far. A gain of just three. A third and seven, perhaps the biggest play of the day for the Northern Illinois defense right now.
Great pursuit by the Husky defense again. McCray trying to find a seam, and it looks like he's got it, and then it closes quickly.
Yeah, I think he banged up his shoulder.
Another nice play by Brandon Bice, and then Mark Ryder comes in to clean things up.
Or did he get a cramp? It could be a cramp.
Well, he's had a long day, a long productive day. But on a third and seven, Husky defensive coordinator Denny Dornbus probably not heartbroken that number five will spend this play on the sidelines. He's had a great afternoon.
You could tell he's a little woozy. He's had the wind knocked out of him, but he has had, as you said, an excellent day. Plus that long touchdown,
which is actually listed as a reception, but
31, Josh Abrams will be the man that replaces Calvin McCray. Everson ducks under center, looks, throws. A horde of red shirts. But it should be enough for an Ohio first down, a gain of eight on the play. Cheeto Nwokocha made the catch.
The Huskies rush three and drop eight. And Everson, boy, he throws a nasty looking ball, but it is always on mark.
First and 10 now.
A huge third down conversion.
Ohio today, 8 of 12 on third down. You're 8 of 12 on third down, and you had 140-plus total offense a week ago. You've really stepped your play up. Down to the sideline to Jim Blaney.
All right, David, the word on McCray and his injury, it appears to be just cramps. They are getting him hydrated, and they are getting some ice onto his right calf. He's staying on the sideline. He hasn't even gone back to the training table. Back to you.
All right, thank you, Jim. A second and 11 situation now.
Again, keep an eye on Austin Everson. Good runner and a good thrower.
Second Toss again to Noah Kocha, and again, it's going to be, look, around 8 yards on that play.
That's the second time Northern has come after the quarterback with an all-out blitz, and they either checked to this swing pass or they had it called.
Third and two, they'll give him 9 on the play.
Everson, whether he's calling his own plays or audible and at the line of scrimmage, just the perfect call for that particular defense.
Again, third and two in the 39, Tom.
McCray still on the sideline.
Nail the man in motion. The toss, swing, and that's going to be awfully close. I think he's got the first down.
Well, Josh Abrams just doing a great job making Husky defenders miss.
Yes, it is enough for an Ohio University first down.
This again, a little swing route. Hansbrough has a chance.
If the initial wave gets him, he's well short.
Did a nice job making guys miss. As you say, the Bobcats have been outstanding on third down today.
First and 10 at the 42. See the Husky tacklers pawing at that football. And Adriel Hansbrough brings Abrams down after a gain of 5. Jim, the rest of your athletic department also looking up. Things going well with the beautiful basketball facility. And Carol Owens is now firmly entrenched as the women's coach. Rob Judson on the men's side. All your other sports, things look
things
really
are good.
Good.
We had a big win in volleyball today. We went to Connecticut and played BC and swept them 3-0. The Huskies shut out the Eagles. I know Tommy cringes when I said that.
My headset's not working. What was that? We'll get to that after this next play.
Mr. Boston College grad was swept by the Huskies today. Everson on that little toss again. And Abrams going to be knocked down. They've run that play fairly successfully all day long.
They have.
Tim McCarthy was the man that made the stop.
Again, Everson does an excellent job setting it up. You know what? Right there, Josh Abrams just not as patient as Calvin McCray was a little bit earlier in the game.
That's the one McCray broke to the house.
That's right. I think Calvin McCray obviously sells it a little better than Abrams. But again, another huge third down.
Ohio University this half, 6 of 6 on third down.
That's tremendous.
That is tremendous. Tremendous productivity. Third and 4 at the 48. The crowd rises again. Everson looking, has time, throws, and it is caught for an Ohio University first down.
7 of 7. Yeah, as you said earlier, Jim, you have to give this Bobcat team a lot of credit.
Well, Jim, we wish you best of luck the rest of the way.
Appreciate it, guys.
We'll see you throughout the season.
Sounds good. Thanks.
All right, that's our man, Jim Phillips, the very fine athletic director here at Northern Illinois. We thank him for stopping by.
This is a very impressive performance by Austin Everson today, the Ohio quarterback.
And this time he keeps it, as you said he would. He'll gain, 5 yards there? Perhaps 5 yards is what they'll call it.
That play has been there all afternoon. As you see now, lots of substitutions on each and every play from the Husky defense. They're just not getting a whole lot of performance from their front 7 today. Bobcats have controlled the line of scrimmage. Their offensive line versus the Husky front 4.
And second and 5.
And
clock drips toward 8 minutes.
They are eating the clock up.
Vonkerry Owens is the man now in the backfield, and Vonkerry Owens is hit. We've got a flag on the play.
I think they've got Tommy stuck, I believe.
Yes, they do. They're going to get Tommy stuck on a hold, and that is a critical penalty.
Now, when you run a lot of misdirection run plays, you've got linemen pulling. There are plenty of opportunities for them to do something
to reach out and touch someone.
10 yards from the previous spot. Still second.
Well, this is huge because Ohio was moving the ball so well, and you see just a horrible decision. Stuck his beat off the top.
He grabbed Keenan Blaylock. There's no question.
Bad decision. Both teams playing disciplined football today.
A whole lot of penalties.
Frank Solich, he and Joe Novak coached in the Hula Bowl together a few years ago. Second 15. Everson throws. And now gain a chunk of it back as Cheeto Nwokocha makes the catch, a gain of six and a third and nine situation.
I tell you, Adriel and Alva Hansbro have really impressed me today with their ability to come up and make tackles in the corner position. Just a great job.
That's a big time tackle.
Adriel Hansbro fighting off a block. Coming up with a big defensive play. Again, the Huskies have to put pressure on Austin Everson.
Crowd into it.
Looks like they're coming after it.
7 of 7 this half on third down. And a long throw, and it's going to be incomplete.
Yeah, miscommunication.
First time this half they've missed on third down.
Justin,
a fourth coming up.
Yeah, Justin Fitzgerald was running a comeback. Austin Everson thought he was running a streak.
Huskies are going to get it back with 6:54 to go.
With the wind.
The drive ate up over 6:30 though. Punt's gonna hit and it's gonna roll into the end zone. Lasher not happy with himself. It rolls into the end zone. 44 yards, a net of 24. Huskies get it at the 20. When we come back with 6:48 to go in DeKalb, Illinois.
Husky fans, Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb is your official pre- and post-game NIU football headquarters. Whether you're catching a game on our big screens or having some of our famous grilled food out in our beer garden, Fatty's is the place to be. Join us on September 9th for our season kickoff outdoor tent party. And don't forget the Fatty's Ultimate Tailgate at the University of Iowa. For more information, log on to fattyspub.com. It's all at Fatty's Pub and Grill, located directly south of Husky Stadium on Route 38 in DeKalb.
A lot of car companies rigorously inspect their pre-owned vehicles. But no matter how hard they look, the one thing they'll never find is this. Drive with your heart. Buy with your head. Certified pre-owned by BMW. Only at your authorized BMW center.
Welcome back to DeKalb. 28-23. The Huskies have the football. They trail by five. Hand off Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf breaking tackles. Garrett Wolf picking his way and may have been hit by a mask as well. May have had it grabbed, and that may tack on 15 more.
Yeah, I believe you're going to get a personal foul on this one. It wasn't a smooth play to begin with. It looked like Phil Horvath and Garrett Wolf had a little trouble on the exchange.
That will be a 15-yard personal foul face masking penalty.
Yep, just a little draw play. He gets some help from his offensive line. And then Garrett Wolf, how many times has Tony Ward swung and missed today? Again, Garrett Wolf will do that to a number of defenders.
Shane Yates was the man guilty of the infraction. Number 74, 6'2", 280, a senior, plays nose guard. Grabbed some face mask. Horvath looking, going long. Looking for Perez, and it's going to be thrown out of bounds. A lot of wind up there.
Yeah, it's a tough day to throw the ball. Again, as Garrett Wolf averages 6.6 yards per carry over the course of his career, I'm not so sure I wouldn't be calling his number on every single down at this point.
Horvath looking, looking, throws. It's got his man. And that's going to be enough for a Northern Illinois. great catch. So now I go back to Coleman with Garrett Wolf.
Well, once again, Garrett Wolf shows you why he's such a valuable player. Phil Horvath rolls out. Wood gets just enough of the outside linebacker to allow this play to happen. Matt Simon, nice reception, a huge first down.
Horvath under center, going to give to Garrett Wolf. Garrett Wolf breaks a tackle. Rips off another chunk of yardage.
I have to say, despite Garrett Wolf's success today, and he's got to be closing in on 200 yards, Matt Muncy, the middle linebacker for Ohio, is a tremendous football player. Just great vision again, but Muncy hangs on a sure tackle. I think you'll see number 50 playing on Sundays in the National Football League next season. Matt Muncy, a great player for that Ohio defense.
Second and five at the Ohio 33. Clock dripping toward 5:30.
Bobcats are coming.
They are. Horvath gets it away, and it's incomplete. He was belted.
Lost his helmet.
Matt, was that Matt Muncy who got him again? It was.
Huge third down. This was the difference between the Bobcat defense and the Husky defense. They actually get a helmet on the quarterback.
Listen to the hit.
Bringing the heat. Thump is never a good sound.
Is that the bug or the windshield?
I think Phil was the bug there.
Incomplete. Trying to hit Britt Davis.
I'm not sure he was going real far with it if he caught it. Just a little wide receiver screen, the bubble screen, and they're running it into the boundary, which means they don't have a whole lot of space to work in. And Britt Davis just doesn't come up with it. It looks like the Huskies are going to go for it here on 4th and 5.
Two timeouts left for Northern. 4th down and 5 to go. Do you dare run the football to Garrett Wolf here?
I think you try to find a way to get it into his hands.
Nearly intercepted again. Tremendous pressure.
Horvath loses his helmet once again as well.
Tony Ward drilled him. And Ohio's going to take over with 5:18 to go.
Again, the Bobcats just get the pressure on the quarterback. They'll take over.
All right, we're going to take a timeout. 5:18 to go. Ohio trying to hang on in charge. 28.
For over 50 years, Blaine's Farm and Fleet has been supplying families with all kinds of quality goods at low prices. And for those big bags of supplies you need for everyday life, no other store offers more. At Farm and Fleet, you'll find water softener salt, a big selection of food for your pets, lots of food for the birds, and their extensive line of agricultural feeds and supplements. You'll appreciate their tradition of convenience, quality, and value. For big bags and more, Blaine's Farm and Fleet is your store.
Bears fans, when the game is over, turn to U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live in-depth post-game coverage. Our all-pro crew breaks down all the excitement, complete with player grades and expert analysis. Plus, we're live outside the locker room with instant player reactions, inside the press room for all the post-game news conferences, and we'll have a preview of the next big matchup for the Monsters of the Midway. U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live after every Bears game, only on Comcast SportsNet. Tomorrow, the Champs playing on Comcast SportsNet. The series wraps up on the South Side as Jim Tomey and the White Sox slug it out with the Indians in high definition. Coverage starts with Velcro White Sox pregame live. White Sox Indians tomorrow at 12:30 on Comcast SportsNet. Every Monday, don't miss Chicago Bears head coach Lovie Smith's press conference from Hallis Hall. He'll break down the past week's game and look ahead to the next Bears matchup. Catch Lovie Smith's press conference every Monday at 5 only on Comcast SportsNet.
Welcome back to DeKalb. We are down to 5:18 to go, and the clock is running.
Little curious, the decision
23 Ohio
on offense by the Huskies on that last drive. Last four downs, they ran it once with Garrett Wolf and threw it three times while in Bobcat territory.
Everson's going to keep it. Everson up the sideline and to the 45-yard line and up for a first down.
He has played a flawless game today. He really has. Does a nice job running the option here. Just the fake pitch. Does a nice job protecting the football as well. Not only gets 11 yards in the first down, also
gain of 11 yards.
Takes care of the pigskin. We were told they were going to split quarterback duty today, Austin Everson and Brad Bauer, but it's been all Austin Everson today.
Yep, Bauer in just for a couple plays while Austin Everson went to the locker room and then came right back and hasn't given the job up since. And McCray breaks across the 35. Actually down to near the 40-yard line.
Well, again,
13 yards on that carry.
The Bobcat offensive line, as they say, is imposing their will on the front four of Northern. McCray's a strong runner. Give him a little bit of a seam and he's going to hit it. You know they're going to take their time getting out of the huddle right now. Lead that clock.
Inside 4 minutes now. They'll hand it off. Gain of a yard, maybe two. Maybe two. Mitch Morcillo. Big fullback. 6'1", 246. Hey, Husky fans. Fatty's Pub and Grill in DeKalb. Great, great place. Is your official NIU Husky tailgate headquarters. Get your tailgate passes today for Fatty's ultimate tailgate at Iowa. October 28th in Iowa City, Iowa. 3 hours of tailgating right next to Kinnick Stadium. It's going to be a great, great time. For more information, go to www.fattyspub.com. Austin Everson rolling, rolling. He's got a ton of real estate and goes down. Boy, it looked like he had that sideline to turn it up, but did not work out that way.
His primary goal was to stay in bounds and not stop the clock.
3:09.
Again, a well-designed play, a great play fake. And right here, tell you what, just a great play also by Keenan Blaylock.
The closeout.
It took the block and made the tackle. A well-timed timeout by the Huskies right here.
Huskies have one left. It's a 3rd and 6. And this is a huge play, to say the least, Tommy. McCray, 83 receiving yards, 82 rushing yards, one rushing TD, one receiving TD in today's game.
Those numbers are impressive, but I think that young man right there, number 9, Austin Everson, is their MVP this afternoon.
Been great.
He's done everything they've asked him to do.
What do you do defensively here?
I think you have to come after him. Sooner or later, the young man's going to make a mistake.
Look at Garrett Wolf, itching for a chance.
You've got two senior cornerbacks in the Hansbrough brothers. Man them up, play press coverage. Take your chances getting to the quarterback. Have not been able to apply pressure to Everson today with just a bland four-man rush.
Again, the sea of Husky red on both sides of the field rises as one. Gun, Everson, pressure, throws, and that's going to be an Ohio first down. Huge play, Calvin McCray. Great throw.
They have game planned perfectly this afternoon. Every time the Huskies have come after them with any number of guys in a blitz, they have either had a swing pass called or a screen called. And again, I think that Frank Solich knew that the Huskies were going to come after Everson. It's just a great play call. And Joe Novak, you can see, just not happy with his defensive effort today.
Bradley Pruitt made the tackle. Clock now at 2:40. They'll hand it off. Calvin McCray. Calvin McCray to the end zone. Touchdown, Ohio Bobcats. And that could be the backbreaker.
I think I just may have changed my MVP vote from Austin Everson to Calvin McCray. This was a Garrett Wolf type run. Just great vision, bounces it outside, and good speed. He gets to the corner,
and he beats Hansbrough to the end zone. Adriel Hansbrough was the man, 12, who had a shot possibly, but McCray turned down the Jets and he was gone. Extra point up, extra point good. 35-23, 2:31 to go. We'll take a timeout. The Huskies, their backs against the wall. We'll find out, can they answer?
You know, there are some things families just don't like to share.
They don't want to share this.
Or this.
Or these.
Or this.
That's why with U.S. Cellular's family plan, everyone in the family gets their own phone. Plus, they can talk to each other free.
Speaking of which, does anyone want to talk about these?
Oh, those are Dwayne's. See, you thought you lost them.
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Right now, get up to 4 free phones when you buy one for only $29.95.
Stop on in. We've got what you need. Stop on in. You're on the run.
At Casey's, we don't do thin and skimpy pizzas. Casey's piles them up real heavy. All month, get free cheese breadsticks with the purchase of any large pizza. Come in now and enter to win the Snickers Casey's Super Bowl Celebration Sweepstakes. You and a friend could end up at Super Bowl 41 in Miami.
Stop on in to Casey's General Store.
All right, 2:31 to go, Tom Waddle. 35-23. Do you realize that the two backs today, McCray and Wolf, McCray actually has more total yards.
Well, combined, they're up over 400, aren't they?
That's correct. McCray is just over 200, 206, I believe. Passing, receiving yardage, and rushing yardage. Garrett Wolf has nary a yard in the receiving game, but 196 on the ground. Marcus Perez, 1 yard deep in the end zone. And he'll be knocked down at the 13-yard line. 14-yard return.
I tell you what, the Bobcats have just played great football today. Special teams, offense, defense.
By number 4, Andrew Lawrence.
Frank Solich has got to be very happy with his performance, the performance from his players today.
Take a look at the scoring drive for Ohio. 6 plays, 67 yards. Took 247. McCray bounces it to the left corner of the end zone on a 24-yard TD run. Horvath looking, throws, incomplete, and a big, big hit from Todd Koenig.
Now Todd needs to settle down because that's just a quarterback unfortunately laying out his receiver.
Matt Simon, the intended receiver.
Phil Horvath just throws his ball behind Matt Simon. You know, it's okay to be excited about what you've done, but you basically what you've done is you hit
a defenseless guy.
You know, did a nice job, get back in the huddle and act like you've been there before.
Horvath looking, throws, nearly intercepted.
I will say this: the last hit that Koenig put on Matt Simon, I think, was still on Simon's mind right there. Phil Horvath, who has been very accurate throughout the course of his career, just throwing it behind guys, above guys. Matt Simon was quick. I can't say I blame him, but quick to bring his arms down on that play.
3rd and 10 for the Huskies from the 14.
Horvath looking, throws, Brett Davis has it, and it's a first down for Northern Illinois. They had to have it, and they got it.
Again, a little high, but Brett Davis comes up with a big catch.
Horvath looking, going down the field. Brett Davis, the intended receiver, and it was thrown a little high for him to be able to corral. 1:59 to go, 12 down.
Well, they're a little out of their element right now. They're a run first, throw second football team with Garrett Wolf in the backfield and a group of inexperienced wide receivers. But it just has not been Phil Horvath's day. He's taken some crushing hits and really been inaccurate. back there in the pocket.
Horvath looks, throws, finds Brent Davis, and he grabs it.
Now down 12, you're going to need more than 5 yards a clip. Less than 2 minutes to play.
Third and five at their own 32-yard line. Horvath looks, throws, got his man, and that's going to be a first down. It'll stop the clock. Brandon Davis, junior out of Broadview, Illinois, with the catch. Good throw by Horvath.
That's a well-thrown football right there. Horvath throws it in a perfect spot. Brandon Davis with a nice catch as well.
22 yards on the completion. From Horvath to Brandon Davis.
And only 5 or 6 seconds off the clock.
Horvath with time, throwing. And Brent Davis looked like he might have had it. They'll call it an incomplete.
Boy, he had Garrett Wolf in the flat all by himself. Garrett Wolf doesn't even look like an option in the passing game right now.
No.
And it's something I talked about before the game kicked off, something Joe Novak coming into the season was really interested in, getting Garrett Wolf more involved in the passing game, and today, nary a catch.
What about a draw play here?
No. You've got one timeout left. You certainly want to use the clock.
Horvath going down the field and is broken up. Flag flies.
And may have one of the Bobcat defenders on a holding call. Matt Simon just running down the middle of the field. Wow. Marcus Parham gets called for the hold. Not sure there was an infraction.
Defensive
there.
Pass interference. Number 27 of the defense. 15 from the previous spot. First down.
Big break for the Huskies. That's going to give them an automatic first down with 1:37 to go. And all of a sudden, they're at the 32 on a first and 10. With one timeout left.
And the wind continues to kick up.
Horvath throws. And that one's in the middle of the field.
No, you can't
to
do that.
Jake Nordine.
You can't do that. Not as a senior quarterback. You know, with a minute and a half left to go, down 12, you've got to work the sidelines.
That will be their final timeout.
I think he's getting an earful right now. Really bad decision.
John Bond is the offensive coordinator.
I don't think he even really looked elsewhere. I think he looked right at Jake Nordine and hits him in the middle of the field. And that may be a good decision midway through the second or third quarter. But with a minute and a half to go, down 12, I'm not sure that's the right decision. They burn their final timeout. And I know Frank Solich would be willing to give them 6-7 yards a clip down the center of the field from here on out. Really, from top to bottom, you can't say it enough. The Bobcats just have come to
play,
and they played a great football game, and it happens.
That's exactly right. They deserve the. They have played a whale of a football, no doubt. Second and three. Horvath, a lot of time. Throws, has a man open, and it is dropped in the end zone.
Again, that's the second time we've seen a Husky wide receiver drop a sure touchdown.
This one, Brent Davis
just took his eye off it again, running all by himself at times, a little bit of a pick route. At times, this is the most difficult catch in football. He just took his eye off it. Wow, almost hung with it, but you cannot drop two short touchdowns and make the mistakes the Huskies have all afternoon and expect to win.
Horvath looking, pressure, throws, got his man, and he'll rumble out of bounds with another Husky first down. Clock at 1:17. Jake Nordine.
Now this is what you have to do in a two-minute drill. He does a nice job getting the ball to Nordine on the outside. Jake does a fantastic job getting out of bounds and stopping the clock.
You see him stretching for every yard he could get. Horvath steps up, throws, and nearly intercepted. Looking for Britt Davis.
Threw that into double coverage.
What, are you trying to swing it to Garrett Wolf here?
Yeah, that has just not been one of the options.
Well,
today.
See again, Horvath, you see him at the top of the screen.
Horvath steps up, and Tyler Russ almost comes up with the interception for the Bobcats, but you're right. It doesn't look like Garrett Wolf is even an option in the passing game. There have been several occasions when he's been left alone out on the edge, and Phil Horvath just hasn't looked to him.
Horvath with pressure coming, throws and gets rid of it. They've got their ears pinned back and they are just coming at the quarterback.
And a great opportunity to maybe sneak Garrett Wolf out of the backfield and hit him quick the way that the Bobcat offense has done with McCray today.
Todd Koenig was the man with the pressure on Phil Horvath.
I mean, a screen pass would be a bad option as well if you think the Bobcats are coming after you.
Horvath to the end zone, tipped away.
Boy, again, Garrett Wolf's just non-existent in the offense at this particular time.
Fourth and 10 at the 14.
This one just sails on Horvath, throws a post route. Again, if you're gonna throw that route, you gotta throw it on the back shoulder, throw it away from the defender. Garrett Wolf. Just not being utilized.
Garrett Wolf, no touches on this entire drive.
And here come the Bobcats again. Slip him out of the backfield and hit him.
Horvath with a lot of heat coming, tosses it up.
And it went through his arms again.
And that one looked like Britt Davis might have had a shot at it. And Ohio's going to take over and win the football game 35-23. Let's take a look at that last play.
Yeah, it's maybe a tough catch, but it's one that
you gotta make.
You gotta make.
Threw it to the back corner of that end zone, that back box area.
Yeah.
And just couldn't come up with
it. On three occasions today,
Horvath has had his moments where he struggled, but you've got to tip your cap that he threw three balls today that should all have resulted in touchdowns.
Correct.
He has got to get better play out of his wide receivers. Ohio will take a knee, and that is going to do it.
Huge win for Frank Solich and the Ohio Bobcats. To go on the road, their opening game of the MAC conference play, and to come away with a victory against the team that was the preseason favorite to win the conference. Huge win for Ohio today.
McCray, 204 total yards and three touchdowns. Wolf, 196, all rushing, two touchdowns. Again, a huge thanks to our crew today. Our spotter, Hollywood Todd Armour, and the best stat man in the business, Ethan Cooper. We'll take a quick timeout. We'll come back. We'll wrap this puppy up. Tough loss for the Huskies. They drop at 35-23 right here on Comcast Sportsnet.
Advance your career with an MBA from Northern Illinois University.
I was able to balance my MBA with my professional life as well as my personal life. And best of all, NIU's MBA program is AACSB accredited and affordable.
I was impressed with the knowledge and experience of the professors, and the program provided me with a well-rounded business education. The affordability and convenient locations made my decision easy, and it made my MBA a reality.
Designed for the working professional, the MBA program at Northern Illinois University. Jumpstart your career today.
This broadcast of Northern Illinois Husky football on Comcast Sportsnet is brought to you by
U.S. Cellular, we connect with you. Fatty's Bar and Grill, the official tailgate home of NIU Athletics. Village Commons Bookstore for all your Husky clothing and souvenirs. Visit vcbs.com. Applebee's, try Applebee's Car Side to Go. You call it in, we bring it out. Casey's General Stores, the official convenience store of NIU Athletics. Casey's, a convenience store and a whole lot more. Blaine's Farm and Fleet, I found it at Farm and Fleet. The NIU MBA programs, take the NIU MBA Challenge. The NIU Alumni Association, stay connected with NIU. And Kishwaukee Hospital.
Welcome back. It's our Casey's General Store post-game show. David Kaplan, Tom Waddle, Jim Blaney back with you. And Tommy, you got to give all the credit to that group of guys right there.
No question. They won the battle at the line of scrimmage. That offensive line for Ohio dominated the front four of Northern, and their senior quarterback, Austin Everson, an outstanding job managing that Bobcat offense.
And our Adidas player of the game, we could have gone a couple ways, could have gone Austin Everson. We decided Calvin McCray.
Over 200 total yards. He was outstanding running the football, a very good receiver out of the backfield. Just had too much for the front seven of the Huskies. Great quarterback play, great running back play, and let's give those offensive linemen some credit as well. Ohio, mistake-free football. He fumbled it one time. It did not come back to hurt them, but as you see, Calvin McCray, a huge game.
Huge game for Calvin McCray, and we congratulate Frank Solich and the Ohio Bobcats as they come into DeKalb, a decided underdog, and win today. It simply just outplayed the Huskies.
They certainly did. That front four defensively for the Huskies and the entire defense has got to come up with a better effort if they're going to get back on track in MAC conference play.
Don't forget to join us next Saturday, 6:30 p.m. We'll be here. The Huskies will battle the Buffalo Bulls live from Husky Stadium. If you can't be there, join us right here on Comcast SportsNet. So for Tom Waddle and Jim Blaney, I am David Kaplan saying so long from Husky Stadium in DeKalb, where the final score was 35-23 Ohio. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of Comcast SportsNet and Northern Illinois University. Have a great weekend, everybody.
There'll be none of this, or this, or this, but lots of this. We're a lean, mean dealing machine at Schomburg Honda Automobile.
Get 4.9 APR for 24 to 60 months now.
There's only one, Bob Roman.
You owe it to yourself. The Midwest number one volume Honda dealer, Bob Roman Schomburg Honda Automobiles, just 8 blocks west of Woodfield Mall on Golf Road.
Wish your job was actually getting you somewhere. Do all your friends with careers seem to be zooming right past you? Now there's a degree that can launch you into a serious career fast. DeVry's new Electronics and Computer Technology program. So fast, you learn your degree in less than 2 years. But you need to move fast because classes are starting real soon. So go to DeVrySuccess49.com now. Get their free guide to today's hottest careers. And see how their new tech program is all about you. You learning hands-on. You getting one-on-one attention. Flexible class schedules so you can keep your job while you study. Then pretty soon, not only will you have an outstanding tech career started, a lot of other cool things will start zooming your way too. Oh, and one more thing. This great tech program even provides use of a laptop to carry with you. But you've got to call or log on now to DeVrySuccess49.com because classes start soon. DeVry, where success stories begin.
Vasher's going to retrieve it in the end zone. Now he's going to run it out. Vasher spinning away from a tackle. Now running right to the 15. Vasher to the 25, 30. Vasher midfield. Vasher to the 40, Vasher to the 30 of the Niners, Vasher on his feet at the 15, 10, 5, oh yeah, baby, oh yeah, Nathan Vasher goes coast to coast.
And the Chicago Bears have clinched the NFC North. They have clinched a first round bye. They are the number 2 seed in the NFC. They sweep the season series from the Green Bay Packers.
Ah, yes, the 87th NFL season kicks off this weekend. Welcome to Countdown to Kickoff, presented by IPA. I am Pat Boyle, alongside the star of this show, number 87 from your Chicago Bears, Mohsin Mohammed. I know you're ready for the pack on Sunday. Are you ready for 16 weeks of your own TV show?
I got to be ready, Pat. I mean, I'll have that game face on Sundays, and when we come do this show, I'll have the game face on again.
All right, well, we got a lot to get to the next 30 minutes. Let's check out our playbook here. It happens in just about every NFL city. Chicago's no exception. The great quarterback debate. We'll find out how the players are reacting to Rex at the helm again. Moose will tell us what the team is saying about the pecking order at running back and wide receiver. Plus, Brett Favre still have what it takes to be an effective NFL QB. Then it's two-minute drill. Moose is chomping at the bit on this one. Does he need to change his touchdown celebration? What teammate would he drive to Lambeau Field with? Just a sampling of what we'll find out from him in our hurry-up segment. But first, it's time for our opening slant. And it's the guy who will be leading you on Sunday, Rex. I think everyone would admit it was a less than stellar preseason for him. Looked pretty good last week, though. Meanwhile, Brian Greasy had the better numbers. Are you and your teammates confident that Rex is the right choice at quarterback?
Yeah, I believe so. I think Rex is the right choice. I think the coaching staff know what they're doing, putting Rex at the helm. He's a gutsy guy, makes some incredible throws, and I think he's going to be ready for Sunday.
You said something a couple weeks back, that those that know the game know that Grossman showed more in the preseason than his numbers showed. What did you mean by that exactly?
Well, you know, when you look at the game and you look at some of the throws that Rex made, you're talking about tight spirals in the traffic, you know, pinpoint accuracy. You know, those are some gutsy throws. And he's shown that he has the strength in his arm. He has the timing. He has the touch on the deep ball. And he has what it takes to be a starting quarterback in the NFL.
Rex certainly made some positive steps last week in Cleveland. He was 5 of 8, should have had 2 touchdowns. One was dropped in the end zone. That said, he's certainly feeling the heat from Bears fans. Here's what Rex had to say on that topic.
And I've played 8 games, so, you know, there's not a lot to go on. You know, I mean, sometimes it feels like I'm judged on every pass that I make, whether it's a good one or a bad one. Think I'm, you know, make a good pass, I'm a good quarterback. I make a bad pass, I'm a bad quarterback. And that's just how it is when you're not really established. And that's definitely one of my goals this year, is to get established as a quarterback for this franchise and the league. But really, I'm not worried about it too much. I'm just worried about going and beating the Packers, and that all should take care of itself.
Well, Moosey makes a good point that he's being judged on every throw, and I think that's a product of just playing 8 games in the 3 years that he's been here. Solid start to the season was really important for him, so he doesn't hear people calling for Greasy, don't you think?
Well, I think it is important to come out to a fast start, but more important, you know, Rex just has to be comfortable in there. We put a lot of pressure on him as fans. We put a lot of pressure on him as coaching staff, teammates. He has a lot of things to think about. And what Rex needs to do is just relax, play the game that he loves, and be himself out there.
And quickly, before we move on, you were impressed with what Greasy did, too. Were you not?
Definitely was impressed with Greasy. I mean, as a guy coming in, having to learn a new system and perform under that new system, he did a great job. And we're expecting big things if Greasy has to play.
Let's move to the other debate. Thomas Jones versus Cedric Benson. Jones will get the start against Green Bay, his third straight season opener in that role. Had Benson been healthy, probably would have been his gig. What's your take now on the running back debate?
Man, we have a great dilemma on our offensive team. You got 2 starting quarterbacks. You got 2 starting running backs. I'm happy to see that Thomas Jones is going to get in there, carry the load. Here's a guy that, you know, practically carried the offense last season with us. Having to throw the ball sparingly, we put a lot of weight on his shoulders, and I think it was like that the previous year before I got here. So Cedric Benson, with him being banged up, he gets a chance to learn. When he gets in the game, he's going to be fresh. He's going to be hard to take down, and defenses are going to have to look out for those two. 1-2 tandem is going to be one of the best in the NFL.
You make a great point. Last year, they knew you guys were going to run the ball, and he still ran for over 1,300 yards. Here's what Jones had to say as he looks to build upon last season's effort.
You know, obviously to have a good year is It's definitely something that helps your confidence and definitely makes you work harder the next year. And that's what I'm trying to do now is work as hard as I can to have the same type of year or better year this year. Well, everyone can improve every year. So, that's the goal, in the offseason, to work out in the offseason and to do all the things that you're doing to get prepared for the season and so you can be better than you were last year. So everybody can get better. I'm trying to get better, too.
All right, Moose, I'm going to put you on the spot. If everyone is healthy, Jones and Benson, who do you think should start?
Well, I'm glad that I don't have to make that decision. I'll tell you what, Pat, because, there's two guys there that can really run the ball. And you know what Sed has done in his college career.
Right.
And we know that Thomas Jones is a proven running back and basically what he did. And after he's proven himself and the trust of the teammates, I would have to go with the veteran until Sed Benson is ready to go.
Oh, a lot was made about Benson leaving the sidelines early in that second preseason game, skipping the team meeting that night. Did that create more of a rift between Sed and the team?
Well, I don't think so. I think that, we have to handle some things as professionals, and Sed knows that he made a mistake, and the team recognized that. Actually, when the news came out about Sed missing the game, it was washed away before people even knew about it. So it was really a mute issue to us, and we took care of that. Most deals that go down like that are taken care of in-house, and the team is the one that take care of those type of things.
And the fact that it got out of house, did we find out who kind of told the Sun-Times that, or is that still top secret information?
Well, I think we need to look at guys in the organization, maybe some top-level officials or something like that. I don't think there's a player on the team that would leak that kind of information, so I think it came from somewhere else.
All right, well, here's Benson on his relationship with his teammates.
That seems all right. I don't really know what they may think deep down inside. But they're giving me the impression that everything's cool, so everything's fine with me. I don't have a problem.
Bottom line, he's the fourth overall pick a couple years back. They got a ton of money invested in him. Like it or not, he's going to get a chance to show his stuff this year, don't you think?
He has to, and basically when you look at the way everything went down last year with Thomas Jones, we had other guys that came in, and Cedric Benson was one of those guys that came in and had a chance to play. Adrian Peterson had a chance to play. Sed Benson is going to get a shot to play, and he knows that. I think he's earned the respect of the teammates, and he needs to go out on the field and earn the respect of the fans and everyone else that has believed in him and will believe in him.
All right, let's get to your position. Wide receiver, trying to figure out who's number two, number three, top priority during training camp. It's been tough because there's been a lot of injuries there. After you, is Bernard Berrien number two in your eyes?
Bernard Berrien is the number two guy.
All right.
And he'll probably start this weekend. I don't know if the coaches have come out and actually given a starting lineup, but, if I had to guess on anything, I would say that Bernard Berrien is a guy that can come out and make things happen. And he's proven to me that he's capable of being a starter in the NFL. Until that point, we'll have to look and see what the other guys can do. And some of the guys are banged up, battling with injuries, and have to get healthy.
Well, let's take a look at the preseason numbers from the wideouts there. And if you had to say right now who might be a number three, Rashid Davis led the way statistically. Gage had a touchdown catch. Who in that group do you think emerges as a three and also a four?
Well, I think the most solid guy when you look at that lineup there is Rashid Davis so far. Throughout the preseason, he has shown that he can play. Of course, Justin Gage is probably the most consistent guy. He has the most experience. After 4 years of playing, Justin Gage has proven that he could consistently be in the right spot, do the right things. But when you look at a talent level, maybe, Rashid Davis has some more qualities that the coaches are looking for with the speed, and I think he can play the slot extremely well.
Gage is questionable. Bradley also questionable. But practice Thursday. Do you expect them both to be available on Sunday?
Well, I'm not sure exactly how those injuries are. I think that's why they leave it up to the trainers, man. I'd hate to speculate right now, but, I need those guys out there. I want those guys to be able to play. They definitely add a different spectrum to our offense.
Here you are on your show. I've already made you GM, trainer, locker room spy.
Yeah.
I'll take it easy.
You're going to get me in
it.
All kind of trouble, time man. I ain't going to be able to go back to the locker room after this.
I think it's time for our first break here on Countdown to Kickoff, presented by IPA. Coming up, we'll hear from Brett Favre, who's had a lot of success against the Bears in his career, but not recently. Number four will reflect on his Chicago experience. And later, what did Moose take away from last year's division title? Did the playoff loss to Carolina serve as a reality check for the Bears? And how does the new NFL rule changes limit his touchdown celebration? It's all coming up in the Hurry Up. Stick and stay.
Introducing the new Escalade EXT and the extended Escalade ESV.
After the Bears game, turn to Comcast Sportsnet for U.S. Cellular Bears postgame live. Our expert team breaks down all the action and brings you live player interviews and press conferences. U.S. Cellular Bears postgame live after every Bears game on Comcast Sportsnet. Today, Cubs baseball plays on Comcast Sportsnet. Derek Lee leads the way for the Northsiders as they battle Andrew Jones and the Braves in Atlanta. Coverage starts with Cubs pregame live presented by Verizon Wireless. Cubs Braves, today at 5:30 on Comcast Sportsnet.
He can put the ball anywhere he wants to, you know, and the thing about him is you can have a chance to make plays, but you got to make them. You know, he throws the ball hard, so if you get a chance to catch it, you better catch it. Like I said, he'll make some throws that most guys won't make or won't even attempt to make, and he'll make them and be successful with them. But there are times when he's not successful, too. He's got to take advantage of those times.
Well, Urlacher and that Bears D certainly handled Favre last season. Welcome back to Countdown to Kickoff with Musa Muhammad, presented by IPA. The Bears are gearing up for their season opener at Lambeau Field, a.k.a. Brett Favre's office. He'll be making his NFL record 222nd consecutive start. Wow. That is mind-boggling right there. But he wavered back and forth about retirement. Apparently, he had a family vote. Mm-hmm. If there's that much doubt in his mind, can he make it through 16 weeks with all that you have to deal with as a quarterback in the National Football League?
Man, that's going to be tough, you know, and that's all going to weigh on Brett. I actually heard a statement that he made about possibly going to another team. And,
right.
You know, the reality hit me one day when I saw Jerry Rice out of a 49er uniform. And who would have thought that Jerry Rice retired with a different – excuse me, he retired as a 49er, but actually wearing a different jersey. You know, you never thought you would see that one day. But in this – day and age, with free agency and the way things work out with restructuring of teams, you never know how anyone's career is going to end up now.
Yeah, he said he may go to another team. Do you honestly think he would?
Well, I think if the opportunity presented itself and the money was right for him, and like he said, if Green Bay decided to go in a different direction and they no longer needed Brett Favre, well, what kind of choices are they going to leave him?
Well, Lovey is trying to become the first Bears coach ever to win his first three games at Lambeau Field. Meanwhile, Favre is trying to rebound from last year's 0-2 mark against Chicago, but he's had more success than not against the Bears over his career, as number four reflected upon this week.
From a one-loss standpoint, there's a lot more wins than losses. And as I think back, all I can think back to is, you know, there's been some great games, but I think back to last year, they had the upper hand on us. You know, they played great football last year, and it makes you appreciate those years when we were beating those guys. And so it's kind of like starting over, even though I'm an older player. You know, I mean, I'd love to get back on top, not only against these guys, but against everyone.
I know, we hope the current trend continues, but the Pack, they're going to honor that Super Bowl 31 championship team before the game. There's going to be a lot of emotion there. How important is it for you guys to make sure that celebration doesn't carry over into the first quarter?
Well, it's going to be similar to a playoff game where there's going to be all kind of antics, all these different things going on before the game, you know. We just got to stay focused, man. Let them shoot off the rockets and sing the songs and drink the beers and eat the hot dogs and then get ready to go play a football game.
It's always nice going to Lambeau right now, early on in September, rather, in November, December.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what. I mean, we're going to have to play our first game against, Green Bay, and then we're going to have to play our last game against Green Bay. So it doesn't matter where it's going to be at. I mean, it's going to be cold. When they come to Chicago in December, it's going to be very cold for those guys. So maybe we'll have a little wind and, you know, we could shake the lake or something.
Sounds good. Time to let the moose loose on the keys to a Bears victory over the Packers. Here you go. This is all you. What do you have for us?
How are we going to win this game? I think we need to start with the most important thing, the thing that has led us, and that's the defense. You know, our defensive front, guys have been banged up, but now they're back healthy. These guys have got to put pressure on the football, and they got to put pressure on Brett Favre. I think Brett Favre, you know, he's uncomfortable when he has to move around in the pocket and have to be worried about his protection. He tends to throw interceptions and do some, you know, kind of un-Brett-like things when he has pressure on him. Flip it over to the offense. Offensively, we need to run the football. We need to allow Rex Grossman to get comfortable throughout the course of the game, and then we need to hit some play-action passes and have some big plays come out of the passing game. I also look in special teams for Devin Hester to come out with the big run. You know, he came out against Cleveland in the last preseason game and had a really good run. I think he's hungry to get in that end zone.
Devin looked great in the preseason. That's something that you guys struggled with in the kick returning last year. Do you think Cedric Benson will get some touches on Sunday?
Well, you know, if Seth's healthy and he's been cleared by the doctors to play, he's going to touch the football. You know, Thomas Jones is definitely, you know, one of our leaders. He's an emotional guy. He gets things fired up, so he's going to start the game, and then he's going to play a bunch. If he gets tired, needs a break, anything's happened, Sed Benson's going to be in there.
Well, you've heard Moose's thoughts on what the Bears need to do to win at Green Bay, but what about the rest of the season? Coming up, Moose will give us his own personal goals for the 2006 season, as well as the Bears' offense in general. And later, which Manning will prevail in week one, Peyton or Eli? Number 87 will give us his prediction.
America runs on Dunkin's new sausage supreme omelet. Scrambled egg with vegetables, sausage and cheese on a freshly baked bagel. We've made our best tasting sandwich even better. America runs on Dunkin'. America runs on Dunkin's coffee. Made from only the finest beans, it's freshly ground, freshly brewed, and served just the way you like it. America runs on Dunkin'.
I was making room for my daughter's swing set. I was playing in the dirt. I was taking the ponies out for a ride.
When you hit that 250,000-mile mark, you'll remember exactly where you were in a Ford F-Series. Because there are more F-Series on the road with 250,000 miles than any other brand. Now, all buyers financing with Ford credit qualify for 0% for 60 months, saving over $6,600 in interest on F-150.
All right, time now for the debut of the Hurry Up offense brought to you by IPA.
Let's do
it. Here
we
go. 2 minutes on the clock, please. The NFL has cracked down on TD celebrations once again. Do you have a new routine for when you visit the zone?
Well, the NFL is going to be standing for the No Fun League this year. But fortunately, I'm on the right side of the tracks on this one. My dance has actually been approved by the NFL.
They had to sign off on it already?
They actually signed off on my dance, and I was on some video saying that this is the right thing to do. But I may change it up a little bit. You may see some variations, so just stay tuned.
All right, if you could choose one receiver for your fantasy team other than you, who would it be?
Well, I like Marvin Harrison. I like Steve Smith. I'd have to go with Steve Smith for my fantasy team.
All right, and hopefully he'll be able to go this week. We know he's been battling some injuries. If we scroll through your phone over there, give us one non-sports name in there that might surprise us.
Man, I'm going to have to say Tommy Davidson, comedian.
Okay.
Tommy Davidson.
From In Living Color?
From In Living Color.
Okay, we remember that. Eli versus Peyton. Who wins on Sunday night?
I'm going to have to go with Big Brother. You know, I think he's going to show up, have a big game, you know, kind of put his brother in a little headlock and give him one of those little noogie things right there. I just think that he's got the better cast and he's got more experience.
If he doesn't do that, the folks in Northern Jersey will do that to Peyton. Your favorite summer vacation, what would it be?
Favorite summer vacation? I'd have to say the summer vacation I took this summer with my wife. We went to Aruba. And we stayed there for a week, liked it so much, man, we wound up staying an extra 4 or 5 days.
Okay, I got another question for you. If you had to drive to Lambeau with just one teammate, who would be in that car riding shotgun with you?
I would have to say probably Mark Bradley.
Mark Bradley? All right, two CDs you'd have on that trip.
Two CDs, I would have to go with probably like a James Brown CD and maybe a Marvin Gaye CD.
All right, no hip-hop.
No hip-hop, man. We'd just be singing some old-school tunes at the top of our lungs while we're riding down the freeway.
That would be nice. I'd like to see that. Your favorite non-sports TV show? Other than sports, what do you like?
Oh, man, I'm totally embarrassed to say, but I've been watching The Flavor of Love.
The Flavor of Love.
Flavor of Love. But I think my favorite show, all-time show, would have to be Law & Order, CSI.
Law & Order?
Law & Order.
Finally, what's the record going to be this year? What's your flavor going to be, the Bears, when it's all said and done?
I think we have the ability to win at least 12 games this year, maybe 13. So let's go with 12-4.
All right, good luck this week against the Packers. Did you have fun?
I had a great time.
All right, that's going to do it for Countdown to Kickoff presented by IPA. For number 87, Moose and Muhammad, I'm Pat Boyle. See you next week.
Introducing the new 2007 Yukon Denali, the definition of great engineering.
On the next Amiman era, the success of Asigian and others continues to provide inspiration.
Y eso le sirve para los jovencitos que están empezando ahora a jugar este béisbol, que en la vida todo es posible.
Amiman era, Sunday only on Comcast Sportsnet.
Hi, I'm Carlos Zambrano from the Chicago Cubs, and you're watching Comcast Sportsnet.
Welcome to Verizon Wireless Cubs Pregame Live, a beautiful night in Atlanta for baseball. Hello there, I'm Luke Stuckmeyer. He is the crafty lefty, 18 years of big league experience. Dan Plesac sits over to my side here. Dan, the Cubs have lost 16 of their last 20. They haven't beaten the Braves all season long, so I guess they're due for a win tonight.
They're more than due. They're double due. They're due right now. Anyway, this has been a really long season for this Cub team. A lot of injuries to position players. Derek Lee, the main position player, starting pitching, Kerry Wood, Mark Pryor. You can go on and on and on. It's been a very long, frustrating season. And one of the things that's unique about this, it's been 15 years, really, since there's been a meaningless games for the Atlanta Braves. 15 consecutive years winning the National League East, and this is, it's been a long time coming. They're on the outside looking in right now, and I think right now they too are a organization in transition right now with some big time players making a lot of money. What direction are they going to go to? It kind of two teams similar. I think they're a lot more solidified as far as their starting pitching, but I think right now the one thing the Cubs have to do is do the best they can to play the remaining part of this schedule out, as difficult as it will be. And things will get better next season. It's so hard to look at it every day when you're in this grind as a player, but it will get better.
Fans always show up to see the Cubs in other cities, but the Braves fans don't always show up when the team's in the playoffs. Imagine what the attendance is going to be like these next couple series when the Braves are out of it and the Cubs aren't in town. It's going to be slim pickings in Atlanta. Now, consistency in the starting rotation has been the downfall of the Cubs this season. Tonight, Wade Miller becomes the 15th different starting pitcher this year. He's filling in for Carlos Zambrano, who is still suffering from those back spasms. Could be ready for a bullpen session maybe Monday or Tuesday. So our pitching matchup today has Miller going against Chuck James of the Braves. Miller will be making his first start in the majors since August of 2005, when he was with the Boston Red Sox. He had shoulder surgery right about this time last year. Since then, he's made 7 rehab starts for the Cubs in the minors, giving up 27 hits in 30 innings. And Dan, what should we look for tonight from Wade Miller?
Well, I'm not sure that you're going to see the Wade Miller that you saw with the Houston Astros at one point. This was a very dominant pitcher. Looked like he was going to be a staple in that Houston Astros rotation, along with Roy Oswalt. He was really the other end of these young and up-and-coming starting pitchers that they had big plans for. He's had some problems, a couple of major surgeries, a setback last season. I think he was brought in really as an insurance policy in case Wood and Pryor began the season. Would they come back eventually in April and May? They weren't, and then his progress was delayed. I'm not really sure what to expect. I don't think you can expect the power-type pitcher in the low to mid-90s with the outstanding curveball that he had before he was injured. I think what the Cubs are hoping for today is they can get 5 or possibly 6 good innings out of him, keep themselves in the game, and hopefully something to build on for the next couple of weeks to see how he progresses.
Cubs signed him to that one-year deal. At spring training, we were hearing, oh, he's right behind Wood and Pryor. He might be back by mid-season or so. This is much later than the Cubs expected to see him in a big league uniform.
It's much later, but anytime you have surgery, a major surgery, and most years will tell you this, anytime you have some problems with the shoulder area, it seems to take longer and there's more discomfort on your road back than problems with the elbow. And I know from pitching 18 seasons, it's a lot easier to deal with little aches and pains in the elbow area as opposed to the shoulder area. The shoulder really is the driving mechanism that allow you
to get up on top and to throw the ball. It's the brakes to slow your arm down after you've released it. And when you have problems with your elbow, you can change grips, you can alter your delivery a little bit, you can change locations, arm angles, and you can kind of get away with a little bit more. But when you have problems with your shoulder, it's really difficult to mask those problems.
And velocity has been the concern for Wade Miller down in the minor leagues while he's been rehabbing. We'll see if he can get it back up into the 90s tonight. Let's take a look at the lineup the Braves will put up against Wade Miller tonight. Giles hit a home run last night to lead off the game. He's playing second. And a guy you don't see in the lineup, Edgar Renteria, has never had a hit against Wade Miller. He's 0-for-22, so that's one reason you wouldn't want to have him on the lineup tonight. But it's an interesting Braves lineup, not the team we're used to seeing in Atlanta.
It's not the team, but I think basically the difference between this Atlanta Brave team in 2006 and the prior 15 seasons is this organization and this team was constantly built around starting pitching, and we touched on it a little bit last night. When you have John Smoltz, Greg Maddux, Steve Avery, the list goes on and on of the quality pitchers, Tom Glavine to that mix. It seemed like whenever they were at a point where, you know, there were a couple of guys were either going to leave via free agency or to make a trade, there was always somebody to plug in, to step in. A Kevin Millwood all of a sudden emerges into the scene. And one of the things that got this Brave team to where they were able to win 15 division titles is their starting pitching was rock solid. And I think right now, a little bit disappointing, last night's starting pitcher for the Atlanta Braves, he just doesn't look as good as he was when he was with the Oakland Athletics. He just doesn't seem to be the same type of pitcher. Tim Hudson, a former 20-game winner. It just seemed like last night he wasn't going to his fastball as much, using a lot of off-speed, a lot of breaking balls.
Okay, time for our nationwide preview. Let's send it out to the guys who are going to call the action. Len Casper and Bob Brenly, guys, we finally get to see Wade Miller tonight. What do you think?
Well, Luke, I think that's the big question. I'm not sure the Cubs know, and I'm not sure Wade Miller exactly knows how it's going to go tonight, his first big league outing in over a calendar year.
Well, I think the big key for Wade Miller tonight, regardless of how he feels out there on the mound, is his command. He didn't walk a lot of batters in his rehab starts in the minor leagues, and he's going to have to keep the ball out of the middle of the plate because this Braves team punishes mediocre fastballs, and it sounds like that's what Wade Miller's going to feature.
By the way, Luke, you mentioned that Edgar Renteria is out of the lineup. Yeah, he is 0-for-22 against Wade Miller, but we understand Edgar is under the weather, had a rough night last night, 0-for-5 with four strikeouts. On the flip side, Bob, Chuck James, a rookie left-hander, first time the Cubs will see him, but coming off one of the better outings of the year.
Well, you know, Dan was just talking about the Braves' ability just to keep plugging in guys. When a free agent leaves, they plug in a guy from their own system, and Chuck James is another one of those guys. He was our minor league pitcher of the year last year. He's pitching extremely well up here at the big league level. And like a lot of the Braves pitchers, he's going to work that outside corner with a fastball and a changeup. The Cubs need to make some kind of adjustment.
We'll leave you with a quick number, guys, and it's ugly. 40 times this year, the Cubs starting pitcher has not gotten through five innings. That's a number that certainly has to change and has to diminish in 2007. Back to you.
Hey, Skip, got one question for you. One of the things I've noticed, you're looking for something right now to look at some positives. I think one of the positives, the last couple of turns, Rich Hill has seemed to have been a different pitcher this second go around. I think one of the things I really noticed the other night, he fell behind Ronnie Polino in the sixth inning. He had a two-ball, no-strike count, threw a 2-0 curveball for a called strike, a 2-1 fastball for a called strike, and eventually got him to fly out to center field. And I think that was one thing that some of these young Cub pitchers are going to have to start to do is to be able to throw their off-speed stuff, four strikes behind in the count. If you look at last night, Angel Guzman, all of the damage was on 2-0, 3-1, 3-2 fastballs. And even though they're located in good spots, when you consistently become predictable, and the only thing you're going to throw when you're behind the count is a fastball, you're really feeding into the opposing team.
Well, I think you said the word predictable, and we talked about it specifically with Rich Hill in his most recent return to the big leagues. He is a lot less predictable now than he was his first go-round. First time around, he'd get to two strikes. You knew you were going to get that big overhand curve, and that hasn't been the case. He's mixed his pitches well. He's had confidence enough to throw that breaking ball when he's behind in the count, and I think that's why he's had success.
All right, thanks, guys. We'll see you in just a little bit. Looking good in the blue Comcast shirts tonight. We appreciate it. It's been an interesting year for the Braves, especially their star outfielder, Andrew Jones. Of course, he was claimed on waivers. Deal was never worked out, so now he's back in Atlanta. He signed through next season, but will that waivers move mean something down the road, Dan? What do you think? If you were a player, Would that bother you if you went to re-sign with the Braves in a year?
I don't think it would bother you. And I think one of the things, the reality about Major League Baseball, when you start getting to that July trading deadline, one of the mechanisms that general managers use to see what kind of interest there is on their roster is, for the most part, every single player is going to go through waivers at a certain point of the season. And what that does, it shows you as a general manager where there is interest on your ball club. And, you know, and sometimes it can really work as a disadvantage. And I'll give you an example. I was with the Toronto Blue Jays in 1997. And we had Randy Myers, who was having a terrific first year with the Blue Jays. And there was a three-team, really, that were battling in the National League West. And Randy Myers, I'm not sure if his arm was completely healthy. He was claimed on waivers, taken back off waivers, tried to run through waivers a second time. And what happened was the San Diego Padres claimed him to block him from going to Atlanta because the Braves were desperately looking for somebody in the back end of that bullpen. Unfortunately for the Padres, they claimed Randy Myers. And the second time, they're revocable waivers. If you run as a team somebody through the waiver wire the second time and they are claimed, that's their property. And unfortunately, it really didn't work out. He wasn't very productive for the San Diego Padres, had surgery at the end of the first season that year they claimed him, and they were stuck with a huge contract for two more seasons. So if you're going to be claiming people on waivers, you have to go into it really making sure that if that claim goes through and the opposing team says, yes, you know what, you can have him, you have to make sure that you're prepared to want to take that player on and his contract if the claim goes through.
I don't think there's any question in the next year you're going to see Andrew Jones get a big contract from somebody, whether it's the Braves or another team in the American League or National League. Cubs have their own questions about who's going to be their center fielder, but let's take a look at that Cubs lineup for right now tonight. And that center fielder is Juan Pierre, who's been pretty hot lately. Ryan Terrio's playing second, and he's been doing awfully well as well in the second spot right there. Derek Lee back in the cleanup spot. Ronnie Cedeno playing short. And there you see Wade Miller, the starting pitcher tonight, his first start since 2005. So what are the Cubs going to do with Juan Pierre in center? Will he give him that hometown discount in the offseason and come back next year after that slow start? He's really been outstanding the second half of the season. And I like Juan Pierre because he's always playing hard. Doesn't have the best arm in center field, but he's always going to run hard to first base. He's always going to run full throttle out there in center field for you. His average is up to 289, and his 49 stolen bases are second in the majors right now. If you were the Cubs, would you bring him back?
Well, I'm not the general manager for the Cubs, but I'll tell you what, you would be really hard-pressed to replace what he brings to this team. Not only does he, and I think one of the things that really goes unnoticed is the fact that he has played a terrific defensive center field. He can go get balls in both alleys. If you would have one knock on his game, would be the fact that he doesn't throw particularly well. But as we've touched on this before, you could count on one hand how many really strong throwing center fielders there are in a game of baseball. That is one of the arts of baseball that has really gone downhill, is outfielders being able to throw and taking pride in throwing. But I tell you what, he got off to a very, very terrible start in April and halfway through May. And since then, he has been one guy that he comes to the ballpark every day ready to play. He plays with a lot of energy. He plays every day. And if he's playing every day, you have to know that the go along with stealing bases has to go along with aches and pains in your lower back and your legs. He's in the lineup every day. He comes with energy every day. And I think they'd be hard-pressed to replace him. And I do think if you look back at the first quarter of the season, and it looked like, you know, was he going to be able to adjust to playing in the cold climate in Chicago, you know, a new city, a new team. And I tell you what, he's answered all of those questions. And I will say this, through the first 50 or 60 games, you were wondering, you know, it was his best baseball past him.
Right.
And I think you're going to find out this offseason that there's going to be a pretty big market for Juan Pierre out there because he can still do some things. He's still young. His legs are still in good shape, and he can run the ball down in the outfield.
No errors in center field this year for Juan Pierre, and for a full season, he might be the best leadoff man they've had since Bob Dernier.
There's no question, and really, I think if you go in a nutshell, and you're trying to point your finger or put a pulse on, if you really wanted to throw the blame on one particular area, and it's a blame that it has to do a lot with injuries. This team is where it's at because the starting pitching has just been in shambles from the beginning of the season. There are four or five guys that are currently on this roster right now that you were hoping that would maybe get a call up in September. Unfortunately, their September happened in April, it happened in June, and it happened in July. And when you're constantly running out young pitching, and pitching that needs more time and more seasoning in the minor leagues. But when you're in a situation where Wood is down and Pryor is down, you really have to just get available arms that you can bring in. Wade Miller, tonight's pitcher, wasn't available because of health issues. I'm sure he was a guy that Jim Henry and Dusty Baker were hoping, if things have gone awry early in the season with Wood or Pryor, that he would be the first guy that would be called up. Some experience, a guy that can, you know, that has been through the wars. Unfortunately for a lot of these young Cub pitchers, they've been thrown right into the wolves. And it's very difficult adjustment being a Triple-A pitcher to the big leagues. And you can see Rich Hill, his second go-around, he's been dynamite.
Well, imagine Wade Miller's probably going to have some butterflies tonight. We are just getting started on Cubs Pregame Live. Stick around. We have to take a quick break to make some money so we can pay for Dan's big contract. When we come back, we'll break down the National League wild card race. Wade Miller and the Cubs getting ready for the Braves.
I am an RMC student.
Robert Morris College, a leader in not-for-profit, career-focused education.
I am a Robert Morris College student.
We are Robert Morris College students.
Offering associate, bachelor's, and master's degrees.
I am a student at Robert Morris.
I am an RMC student.
I am an RMC student.
We are Robert Morris.
Imagine your possibilities.
Honey?
Yeah?
Do you know what this light switch does?
Which one?
The one on the right.
I never use that one.
All right, will you look?
Yep.
On? Off? On?
No.
Are you looking?
Yes.
Off? On? Off? On? Off? On? Off? On? Off?
Life comes at you fast. When it does, nobody covers your car like Nationwide. Investments, retirement, insurance.
Nationwide is on your side.
It was 1995, I don't know if I was in 7th or 8th grade, but it was, write down what you want to do in 10 years, put it in an envelope and open it in 2005. And I guess my mom, last year, found it sitting around the house, opens it up and it says, 2005, I'll be the starting point guard for Chicago Bulls. It's crazy, I knew I always wanted to do it, play for the Bulls, and it's just a dream come true.
If ever you're not satisfied with one of our tires, please feel free to bring it back. Thank you. Discount Tire Company.
Low prices, more choices on the world's best brands, like Michelin and BF Goodrich.
It's all about freedom to see clearly, to be at the top of your sport, the top of your profession, at the top of the world. It's freedom, brought to you by Kraft Laser Vision Correction. No one can match the Kraft Eye Institute in laser vision experience or results. Why trust your eyes to anyone else? The Kraft Eye Institute, it's freedom to see, to do, to be your best. Call Kraft today and see how far freedom can take you.
Bears Blitz every Wednesday and Thursday at 4:30 only on Comcast Sportsnet.
Haven't ordered dinner yet? Then try Giordano's, Chicago's famous stuffed pizza. We made it good. You made it famous.
Grounds crew is getting the infield ready at Turner Field for the Cubs and Braves coming up at 6:05 right here on Comcast Sportsnet. Welcome back to Verizon Wireless Cubs Pregame Live. He's Dan Plesac. I'm Luke Stuckmeyer. Let's check out last night's action. The Cubs lost 8-4 to the Braves. Recap some of what happened last night. Pick it up top of the second, tied at one. Juan Pierre singling to right with the bases loaded. Two-run score, things look good, play at the plate, drop the ball, 3-1, Cubs had the lead. In the bottom of the second, the Braves would get one back here. Brian McCann rips this solo homer to center off of Angel Guzman, his 18th homer of the season. That made it 3-2, Cubs. Then in the bottom of the fourth, it's McCann again, this time with a double to the gap in left center. Run's gonna score on that one. Relay taking a little time here as Andrew Jones scores. And now it's 4-3, Atlanta in front, bottom of the fifth. Andrew Guzman still in the game, giving up the solo homer to Adam LaRoche, his 29th of the season. And the Braves went on to win 8-4, doubling up the Cubs. So the Cubs are way out of the playoff race. The Braves still clinging to some tiny little hope. Atlanta is 6 games behind San Diego, who leads that National League wild card right now. Let's take a look at some of the standings. Phillies just a game and a half back. The Giants 2.5. really the Braves might not have realistic chances there. Dan, we see your former team, the Phillies, just a game and a half back. How about this kid, Ryan Howard, number 56 last night. Still give you sweats if you're facing him?
Well, I'll tell you what, he has been a terrific story for this ball club. I mean, you look at trying to open up a spot for him to be in that everyday lineup, and really what cleared him to be able to play every day was the Jim Thome trade to take him from Philadelphia to the White Sox to give him a chance to play first base every day. He was stuck behind Jim Thome. The Philadelphia Phillies front office really believed that this guy could be a difference maker. And right now, I think one of the things that the Phillies did that the other couple of teams at the top, you see San Diego, Philly, the Giants, and Cincinnati, they made a great trade getting Jamie Moyer. He's not the pitcher he was, you know, 10 or 15 years ago, but he's an experienced pitcher that has played in some playoff competition. He's an experienced pitcher in the month of September. He pitched very well last night, and I think he might be the difference that I think the Philadelphia Phillies right now, if they can get some run production, and a couple of things they have going for them, they have a couple of really good left-handed starting pitchers. Randy Wolf coming back off an injury right now is starting to throw the ball really well. And remember this name, Cole Hamels, one of the best young left-handers in all of baseball, has a chance to be a really, really good pitcher. And right now, John Lieber's picked it up and pitched very well. The problems the Phillies have been in the back end of the bullpen. Tom Gordon just coming back. He missed a couple of weeks with some problems with his shoulder. They had a little bit of a problem until he came back. If he comes back healthy, I think right now this is the one team I think that can catch fire with less than, you know, right around 20 games left. And really, if you look at those top three or four teams, San Diego, Phillies, Giants, and the Reds, you're talking basically about 18, 20 games left. I think it's going to take, if somebody can get on a nice streak on one of those 18-game runs and have like one of those 12-6 spurts, I think that's going to be enough to win the wild card.
You know what's unbelievable about this, and you look at all those teams that are in it, Cubs fans watching have to be just devastated because the National League is so mediocre this year that almost every team is in the wild card race except for the Cubs.
But if you look at the board, and one of the things that is frustrating is the fact that you could look at that board and you're looking at a lot of mediocre teams. The National League, with the exception of the New York Mets, has been very down and very mediocre. But if you look at that board, there isn't one of those teams that has had severe injury problems. Whenever you lose guys like Kerry Wood and Mark Pryor, you know, the expectations of those two coming into the season were you're really had the makings of a terrific pitching staff if they were healthy. You have Wood, Pryor, Zambrano, the now departed Greg Maddux, Sean Marshall. I mean, you had the makings of a pretty good pitching staff, a real good pitching staff if you knew they were healthy going into the season. And if you look at any of those teams, San Diego, San Francisco, they have not lost. San Diego has not lost a one or two starter for very much of a length of time. The Cubs have lost two, and really this game is all about starting pitching. It will begin the season for you. It'll put you in a good spot, and it's really where you're going to go as far as when the season starts to wear down. It takes a light load off of your bullpen. Unfortunately, they haven't had that luxury all season long.
And you mentioned Greg Maddux. The Cubs are expecting to see Mad Dog next Thursday, this coming Thursday at Wrigley Field. So that should be interesting. Time for another break. When we come back in Cubs pregame live, Dan will give us his Lexus keys to the game. That is the Columbus, Georgia Little League team, the World Series, Little League World Series champs being honored in Atlanta tonight.
When it comes to planning for the future, trust Country Insurance and Financial Services to keep you moving in the right direction. With down-to-earth, straightforward advice, Country Insurance and Financial Services is always there to keep you on the right path. Country, real answers for real financial security. For your family, for you, for a lifetime.
This is our country.
Meet the Rosanning brothers, Dick, Ron, Fred, and Al. More than 40 years ago, they came together with one common goal, creating great-tasting pizza. Today, Rosanning's Pizza carries on that family tradition. Our authentic recipes are made by hand, always with the freshest homemade sauce and ingredients. There's so much to choose from. Deep dish, thin crust, chicken and ribs with Rosanning's homemade barbecue sauce, our famous homemade Italian beef, and more. Rosanning's Pizza, a tradition of quality for four generations. Log on to myrosanning's.com to find the location near you.
Get them up! Get them up! Just like our savings. Oak Brook Toyota in Westmont is a lean, mean dealing machine. We've got model year-end clearance savings on the RAV4s, Corollas, and more, plus great deals on the all-new 07 Camry.
There's only one, Bob Roorman.
You owe it to yourself. Get your lean, mean deal right now with Bob Roorman Oak Brook Toyota in Westmont, three blocks west of Route 83 on Ogden Avenue.
Bears fans, when the game is over, turn to U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live for in-depth post-game coverage. Our all-pro crew breaks down all the excitement, complete with player grades and expert analysis. Plus, we're live outside the locker room with instant player reactions, inside the press room for all the post-game news conferences, and we'll have a preview of the next big matchup for the Monsters of the Midway. U.S. Cellular Bears Post Game Live after every Bears game, only on Comcast Sportsnet. On the next Amima Era, for Latin American baseball players, adjusting to American culture can be hard.
Es difícil cuando llega a este país y te sientas y no sabes qué carrizo está diciendo el de al lado mío.
But the success of Ozzie Guillen and others continues to provide inspiration.
Y eso le sirve para los jovencitos que están empezando ahora a jugar este béisbol, que en la vida todo es posible.
Amima Era.